desire, that will I seek after. One thing I desire, that will I seek after. You, Lord, you. One thing I desire, that will I seek after. One thing I desire, that will I seek after. One thing I desire, that will I seek after. Your beauty and your splendor, to see your glory and your power, to see your beauty and your splendor, to see your glory and your power. To see your beauty and your splendor. To see your glory and your power. To see your beauty and your splendor. To see your glory and your power. To see your beauty and your splendor. To see your glory and your power. To see your beauty and your splendor. To see your glory and your power. One thing I desire, that will I seek after. One thing I desire, that will I seek after. One thing I desire, that will I seek after. One thing I desire, that will I seek after. Lord, you, Lord Jesus,
you, Jesus.
To see your beauty and your splendor. To see your glory and your power. To see your beauty and your splendor. To see your glory and your power. To see your beauty and your splendor. To see your glory and your power. To see your beauty and your splendor. To see your glory and your power.
Arrabacar, señor.
desire, then will I seek after. One thing I desire, that will I seek after. One thing I desire, that will I seek after. One thing I desire, that will I seek after.
Jesus, only you, Lord Jesus, only you. Jesus always on my lips. Jesus, only you. Jesus, you always you. Jesus, only.
To the deepest depth, fulfilling. flows like a river. Lord, your love flows like a river. Flow through me, flow, 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 your righteous dream. heart's delight. My heart's delight. My rejoicing. Oh, God. My heart's rejoicing, my heart's delight, my God of my salvation. Salvation, my heart's delight. Oh, my rejoicing, you're my salvation. My heart's delight. Oh, my rejoicing, you're my salvation. You're my heart's delight. You're my rejoicing. Attract you, O God's our heart's desire to see you as we've never seen before, to make our whole lives that which is yielded to you, O God, we look right now. Thank you, Jesus. You know, here's what we want every prayer to be about, every song to be about. It's just winning him, attracting him, and begging him, pleading with him, as it were. You know, the sad reality of it is this church has become almost, church has become a place that advertises Jesus, but it's not been the center of a heart. I mean, if you think about how the Lord would come and adjust our attitudes and our hearts and our perspective of things to where that this meeting was really all about touching Jesus. It wasn't about anything else. It wasn't about how we feel or what we want or what things and ideas we have to advance. But really just about meeting with him, about just longing to see him, longing to know him, longing to be submitted to him, allowing him to reveal himself to us, that he may be revealed through us. So we make things, sometimes we'll make the songs about trying to get people activated. And it's never supposed to be about that. We'll make the prayer about somehow getting people to respond, and it's never supposed to be about that. Well, many times we'll make even the sermons about somehow getting people to listen. It's not even supposed to be about that. So, Father, we ask you in your mercy and we ask you in your grace. Do something, Father, that goes to the point of bringing us to a complete, as it were, new understanding and re-understanding and redefining of that which you hungered and longed to have in the midst of your house, in the midst of the heart of your people. Father, we pray in Jesus' name that your meeting place, that the church will become about seeking you, about longing after you, about interacting with you, that there's really no other purpose, that every song touches you. It's about touching you, about yielding to you. Every word, every prayer, every thought of the mind, every sermon, every exhortation, every prophecy, everything. It's really about coming and ministering unto you, about having you... Father God, about having you fill the place, about having you overwhelm the hearts and lives of every person, about your glory, your face being revealed, your presence being made known. You know, I was thinking today, it's amazing how many people are running around, running in and out of the building. It really runs interference with what God wants to do. People running in and out of the building. God, they got so many things else going on. Don't have anything else going on except for just coming to seek the Lord, coming to wait upon Him. I was thinking today about when the angel of the Lord came down, and he was described by the Marys that saw him and described, of course, and fooled by the Holy Ghost, of course, in Matthew chapter 28, and their appearance was as lightning. They saw them as lightning. It's a hard phrase to translate because they were seen as lightning. So we say, oh, seen as lightning. Well, what does that mean? Well, their appearance was, or their likeness was, or to look upon them was like lightning. And their garments were whiter than snow. And believe it or not, that's not a racial comment. It's about purity. And we live in a world today that things are so messed up. And we're going to have to get some people together somewhere that is going to begin to cooperate with God's word in such a way that Christ Jesus can come and do what he wants to do and be who he wants to be in our midst. Because I'm going to tell you right now, he's not being able to be what he wants to be and do what he wants to do in our midst. It's just the way it is. And it isn't about, you know, condemning anyone. Is it about making anybody feel bad? It's about saying, hey, you know what? We need to get this right sooner or later. Somebody's going to have to say, you know what? Let's do what we need to do to get it right. But at any rate, the angel came and he rolled back the stone and he sat on it. And, you know, it just he's got to relax a little while. And he's sitting there. You can just see him with a big smile on his face. And everybody else, all the guards are on their back as dead men trembling. Okay, here is dead men trembling. So if you can imagine that. And so when you think about, that's the effect of one angel, the presence of one angel. I would like to see a little bit, I'd like to see the effect of a presence of one angel in the church kind of thing. You know what I'm saying? Are you getting where I'm coming from? And did how much more the impact of Jesus when Paul saw Jesus, he fell to the ground. John said, I fell before him as one dead. I was like a dead man, just dead. The impact of Jesus, the impact of one angel, I mean, you need to think about it. The creator of all the angels has so much more impact in his manifest presence. I'm not really interested in some kind of stopping off place. I'm not interested in clap your hands and, you know, unless it was a good meeting. Why was it a good meeting? Well, the word, I understood what was being preached and agreed with most of it. Or the songs were acceptable unto me.
Fine, but was did Father agree with it, and was the songs acceptable unto him? Was the worship that which he delights in? And we've made the church so full of merchandising. We made the church so full of, you know, a promotion. It's about me getting on with ministry. It's about me getting on with, you know, this or without. And who knows, I might get this, write a good song and be discovered and make the top, you know, whatever. I don't know. It's just, to me, there's too much stuff going on other than Jesus. And so the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me not too long ago and said, I'm not really interested in all the singing and all the preaching. And I was really stunned by it. I'm like, oh, no, well, then what are we supposed to do? Because the Lord knows my heart. And you know, I want to hear what he's got to say. I want to be corrected. I want to be directed by him. And the Spirit of the Lord said, no, I'm interested in you flowing in the Holy Ghost that produces singing and that produces preaching and exhortation. But do you know how hard it is to get people flowing the Holy Ghost? I mean, they're scattered all over the place. They're running, they're chasing this and chasing that, chasing their dreams and their ideas. They're frustrated, disappointed, discouraged, got their own agendas, got their own wants, got their own wishes, here, there, yon. I mean, there are so many people that should be here tonight. They're not here tonight because they're distracted with other things. And then to get people here, and then they've got other things. They've got other agendas. Church really is supposed to be about Jesus. It's supposed to be about seeing him. And that's the state of your heart. It's supposed to be, I hate to use the word place a demand upon yourself to make it about Jesus, but that's almost like what it's got to be. But, you know, the reality of it is the Spirit of the Lord tells me in his word that the state of the heart of a new creation should already have something far superior than the need to place a demand upon yourself to do what's right. God tells me that he's moved in, and that he's producing out of the Spirit of the Son all that pleases the Father, that there's this effulgency of divine desire. And the moment you think about the Holy Ghost and who he is and what he is, and all he is about revealing Jesus and pleasing Jesus and doing that which pleases the Father to glorify his Son. I mean, come on now. See, you can't just find a little religious switch and go turn that on for 2 hours or 3 hours in a day, on a day. That's got to be something that becomes something that you live, that you want, that you get up in the morning and say, Lord, I want to live my life for you. I want to know you. That today is not about me making money, playing games, seeing new sights, having it my way, whatever it is that people make their day about. Have you ever written a paragraph on what you made your day about? Try it sometime. Make a paragraph on what my day is about. Make a paragraph on what my Monday is about. At the beginning of the Monday and at the end of the Monday, make a paragraph on what you made the day about, what the day was like. You do that every day, you're going to start getting shocked. Because if you're honest, you know the things, you'll see that, wait a minute, hold up, there needs to be some adjustment. But reality of it is every day, every second of every day is a sacred opportunity for you and I to be able to engage ourselves in that which is supposed to be first and foremost, that which is so wonderful, that which is going to bring everything that we have need of, that which is most important to the Father, that which Father has exalted above better, as better than anything else, that which the Holy Spirit has made bigger and better than anything else, Jesus. And the world goes on, and all the world basically sees is religion. Because religion will always advertise Jesus, will come to the outer, will come just basically and stand outside of the temple. And maybe even as the demon-possessed woman said, hear these men, they speak to us the words of life. They bring to us the message of salvation. We want something deeper than that. I want something deeper. Yeah. If one, at the appearance of one angel, will cause men to fall down trembling as dead people, as it was there when the stone was rolled away. If Paul would fall to the ground as he did in the presence of Jesus, if John would say, I fell as one dead before him, before Jesus. And Gabriel, look at Gabriel. Daniel's impact of what Gabriel did. Daniel chapter 10, all of his strength went out of him. Really, I'm touched that realm. It's like the power supply is cut off. It's like the power supply is shut down and you can't move because someone greater and mightier has just stepped into the room. The author of life has stepped into the room, and everything that is about us bows. Every cell in our body bows. It's true. One day heaven and earth will flee away before his presence because it's going to be intense. It's going to be intense, especially when he comes with a radiant judgment of his glory. One day we're going to be presented before him with all boldness because we're going to stand in the beauty and the splendor of his love and mercy. And there's just things about Jesus Christ that's not being revealed, that God the Holy Ghost wants to have revealed through you and me. And I want to begin to do what I need to do from a leadership perspective to make that a reality. And I've done everything I know. God's my witness. I've done everything that I know. You know, because time has come, it's come to a place in time where if you correct people, you've hurt them. I've been hurt. How did you get hurt? Oh, if I trace it out. Oh, someone corrected you for something that needed to be changed. Oh, I got it. And that's usually the definition of hurt. Someone hurt or offended, you know? You know? It's like one guy, I recently read a little thing, one guy said to another guy, he said, I can't believe how sensitive you are. And the guy responded and said, I can't believe you just said that about me. And so we live in this dynamic of the pride of life. We live in this dynamic of self-exaltation. See, humility and abasement, every bitter word is sweet. When your heart is right before the Lord and you let God be God who he wants to be in your life, do you know what? The reality of it is nothing can offend you. Nothing is discouraging to you. It's all about you're so desperate in knowing him. You're saying, oh, you know, suddenly begin to understand what the prophets mean when they say, I'm going to go up on my high place and see what he says when he corrects me, what he instructs me in the way of life. And so much of the Lord's chastening is really just nothing more than correction and instruction in the ways of life. And he's so earnest to do it. But he sees that when we don't have a heart that's willing to be corrected, we don't have a heart that's willing to be instructed. When we're constantly living with this discouragement, as it were, you know, as a chip on our shoulder, that the slightest little thing that's not going our way that doesn't make us feel high about ourselves. You know what I'm saying? Literally, you know, drunk on self. You know, feeling just, you know, fictitiously good, right? Synthetically good, right? You know what I'm saying? Because you don't really feel good when you're drunk or on drugs. That's all synthetic, right? It's all something that's just messed with your endocrine system a little bit in such a way to where that you are experiencing something that isn't real. People, God has so much for us. God has so much for us. People come scattered from all different areas of life with all their different perspectives and all their different wants and all their different wishes as they're doing all these things supposedly for God and not. And he's looking at us, and I'm afraid that many things that he's saying is, what's double A? What is double an A? I'm going to tell you right now, I really won't have much to say at all, and happily so. When the power of God is moving in such a way in this building that all Southern California is being rocked by it, I really won't have much to say. Because when Jesus is allowed to do what he wants to do in the midst of a church, I guarantee you there's not going to be many people left standing. You know, here's what we do. We begin to think about revival, and we stage it. You know, because I've been down, I've done the drill. I've had people recently been sending me stuff about how they're going to have a move of God and, you know, different places. And one was asking me for advice recently on what to do. And, you know, we're going to get the best musicians that we can find. We're going to do these great songs, okay? And then we're going to find a couple of keynote speakers that everybody's fascinated with. And we're going to have a move of God. Amen. Father ain't going to do that. He isn't going to come in those kind of exalted places. He ain't going to come in those places where men are being exalted, where what suits men is attractive. That's what it's the person, it's the talent, it's the program of men. You're never going to...
I challenge you, find me one place in all eternity where God responded to that. But yet we still don't get it. We still keep doing the same thing over and over again. And then now we got more people, got Father. Supposedly God's got a calendar. And he keeps a calendar, and every 40 years he moves. I mean, give me a break. Or every 100 years, centennial, 110 is a special event. I mean, Jesus. I mean, by what point in time do we just stop and quit trying so hard and then just settled into just making it all about Jesus? Because your heart, I'm going to tell you right now, your heart began to explode with hunger and thirsting because God, the Holy Ghost, will make it happen. He'll make, when we begin to cooperate with truth, when we begin to move in truth, when we begin to speak truth, God, the Holy Ghost, is released to begin to explode on the inside of us. That's why when we talk about the events that we've had in God, it's almost like we begin to have that event all over again. It's when we begin to speak out truth in the midst of adversity, adversity doesn't seem so bad anymore. You know, when we begin a proclamation to begin to say those things which God has set forever settled in heaven, I believe, see, God's word forever settled in heaven. He watches over his word to perform it. So no matter what I go through or what's happening in my life, if I begin to declare his word has already brought the change, and everything has to come under its authority. It's true. I could give you natural physical phenomenon that would exemplify that, but it's not even an issue. The reality of it is I don't need to give any other, you know, examples and parallels concerning these things. What I can do is call you to come to a place where Jesus doesn't become alive at 5 p.m. on Wednesday night. And up until that, he's really not that big of a deal. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Where he becomes the very center of your passion and your heart to touch him, to know him, is something that goes on in your life and you allow it to go on in your life. And when you catch yourself totally out doing something else, you go, wait a minute. How have I become so distracted? How have I become so aloof from reality that I've left off going after him? Because in finding him, you step, and I'm telling you, in finding him, I'm talking about a continual ongoing revelation. Because, you know, people are going to try to make God fit in their doctrines. I'm telling you, he's never going to fit in your doctrine. Paul, who said that Jesus was fully manifested in his mortal body, Paul, who said he had fully preached the gospel with signs and wonders, demonstration of the Holy Ghost, years later said that I may know him. I've suffered the loss of all things and count it but dung that I may win him. God's never going to fit in some neat little idea, logical progression of thought. He's bigger than all of that. But what I'm not going to try to convince you with great lofty words and elegance of speech. And I'd rather sound like I'm drunk with slurred speech and just tell you it's all about you getting a heart where you're just passionate about Jesus. And you begin to let that develop. And tonight, as I minister the word of God, that should develop. And you know, when the musicians are playing and I know Joshua's got a consecration duty, he's committed, just making it about prayer. He's making about, I'm not going to entertain people. I listen to folks say, you know, well, what you got to do is you got to get everybody, sing everybody happy. So what are we doing now? We're singing to the people. Oh, you got to get everybody moving in the right direction and sing the direction and, you know, get them ready for the message. By singing to the people? What is this, a lullaby? What is this to call quiet the devils and the evil spirits? I'm not doing it. I'm not doing it. But the atmosphere demands it. The atmosphere demands it. And you know what? Here's what the reality is. Men of God, across everywhere I've met them, they look on me and they know that what I'm saying is right. They're touched by it, depth in the heart, deep in the heart. They know that I'm saying is right. They just didn't know what to do to change it. Because it cost everything to change it. And you know, and I know the challenge that is before us, because I've got a church full of really good people, really right people, right-hearted people, and it's very difficult to get everybody together. It's like a picnic. But we're just playing another kind of game. This is sing-along game kind of thing. And we got to go deeper. It's got to be deeper. And you're not going to go deeper just by showing up. You're going to go deeper by learning how to ascend. Ascend into His presence. You're going to go deeper by learning how to abide. Abide in His presence. You're going to go deeper by learning how to just so turn your life over to Him. I mean, listen, everything that Father has, He's made free. It's free. It's absolutely without charge. But it's still just as sacred as it's always been. When he's saying, come on in and behold me, it's still just as awesome and dreadful as when he was saying, draw not nigh. It's just that he's made a way for you and I, who with hunger and thirst and with a sacredness of heart and sincerity of heart. See, Papa's still looking on heart. And he's made a way for those with a true and sincere heart to be able to come on in and behold him and interact with him in unlimited realm, an unlimited way. And that if you want to be a part of a move of God, which we've got all these various different terms, revival, great awakening, on and on. If you want to be part of the movings of God, things got to be adjusted in your heart. And there's crossroads all day long that Father's looking at and he's examining and saying, no, you're going to have to, I want to change that. And then he goes to working with us to try to correct us and instruct us so that that attitude and those dispositions and those responses are changed. But a lot of times he can't get our attention because we're busy working for him. Everything from making money for the kingdom to doing something in the kingdom. I don't know. So I just want you to hear. I want you to hear the cry of the heart of the Lord. I just want you to hear it. I want you to just hear it. I want you to just. It just says the Lord's saying, "Come, behold me," and it should be. Whoa, that is amazing. That is beautiful. And it's like especially important for Thursday morning at 7 o'clock in the morning. Come, behold me. But unfortunately, it's not real special at that moment of time. And it's got to become special. There's a transition. Got to become special. There's wanting to touch Jesus, know Jesus, see him in a great way, have a greater encounter with him, has got to become bigger to us than the songs that we sing, the titles that we hold, the ministry that we want, the doctrines that we agree with. Father wants to give us wisdom and insight. He says, and wisdom says, they that love me, I love them that love me, and those who seek me early shall find me. And if there's anything we need to have to understand is that spirit of wisdom and revelation and knowledge of him is absolutely essential if we're gonna be able to participate with what Father has for us. And so, I mean, I want the musicians, I want you guys to pray about it. I want to make sure that the sound isn't distracting. I want rejoicing and shout of joy, but I want it to be more than just a human inspiration. I wanted to go deeper, and I can feel the anointing, and it's deep and it's good, but it's just like I look out at people and I see people, some people here, some people there, some people caught up, some people not so caught up, some people standing up, some people laying down. I mean, if we can just begin to do everything together, if you could just begin to follow the leader, if one stands up, everybody stands up. If one claps their hands, everybody claps their hands. You know, if one shouts glory, everybody shouts glory. I mean, if you could just begin to do what everybody else is doing, if you could begin to give yourself to doing what everybody else is doing instead of, everybody independently only doing what they're doing. When I feel like it. And that's just what it is. It's really awkward looking and weird. But that's not how the Lord wants to train us. And you know how difficult it is to get everybody to clap at the same time? To say amen at the same time? To stand at the same time? It's difficult. You get everybody to sit down at the same time, usually. Get everybody to be quiet at the same time? No problem. I'm so hungry for Jesus. I personally don't want anything but Jesus. I just want Jesus. I don't even want to be in the ministry. I just want Jesus. I'm not interested in nothing. I'm not interested in nothing. I'm not interested in, my heart is not attached to anything. I was standing out on the balcony of the house that we're living in right now, and the other night, pretty late at night, just standing out there praying, and just doing inventory, just looking around. I said, that don't mean nothing. That don't mean nothing. That don't mean, Father, I just thank you that my heart's not attached to anything. Nothing means anything to me. I can walk away from everything right now. All you got to do is call me. Call me now. I'll come wherever you want. I'll go to Kashmir right now. Where do you want me to go? I'll go to the moon. There's nobody there. I'll go wherever you want me to go. Wherever you want me to go. I mean, it'd be pretty taxing to try to get to the moon if the Lord called you to go to the moon. But, you know, you could work it out. There are vehicles traveling. Rarely, but wherever you want me to go. Of course, he'll work out wherever he wants to go. Fuck, where do you want me to go? What do you want me to do? Can I get you to start doing that with your life? Can I get you to do that? Yes. Can I get you to just shut off all whatever it is, the busy stuff? But we got bills. Get rid of your bills. How do you do that? Give it to God. And when you give it to God, if you get kicked out of your house, you know what God wanted? He wanted you out of there. Are you listening to me? Hello? Yes. Nah, not too many people going to walk with God like that. How many Abrahams are there in the place tonight? You think about it, how many. I'm an Abraham. Father tells me to go. I'm gone. I'm on it. Now listen. Well, then you need to translate that over into an expression of the Holy Ghost. Then you need to translate that over into a moving of God in your life. Because you can say that all you want, but till there's an outworking, none of us know it. And God has purposed that it be an outworking. There's something that we should be able to see. I'm going to talk about that tonight. There's something that we should be able to see. And then, you know, if you be one, you could look, there is a coming together. There is a that isn't, oh, I got to start praying in the Holy Ghost. Other pastors are going to think that I'm really, you know, not doing what I need to be doing. And then it's going to be about men again. Instead of it just, you know, just not trying. People try way too hard. Just trying too hard. Best advice you could have is quit trying so hard. Relax. Make it about Jesus. Ha takana meya. Get on your face, start hungering before and thirsting before God till there's a siporanaya tik. A kana mosipikiaka. A flatapotari. A flapatotamos. A flow. Ha fatiya prabahafate. That you don't have that mosikita. That you don't kosikatapa. You don't karata basiati. You don't create it. It's created in you by the Holy Ghost. And it has an outwork and an expression that changes the atmosphere that you're in. The tongues that come out of me changes my disposition and my emotions. It has a change on me every time. It affects me. It affects not only me, it affects everybody around me. It affects the atmosphere. Hallelujah. But you know, that's not hard to understand, is it? Because when you frown, you affect people in one way, and when you smile, you affect them in another way, right? The countenance on your face has an atmosphere change. How about the Holy Ghost, God talking and speaking through you? How about an atmosphere change with that? Hallelujah. Mon Dieu de si canest. I mean, we could. I'm Dimbo Ratani. I'm going to tell you, can I be honest with you? I don't know a person who's had an encounter with God that is ever satisfied with a church meeting. It's like, Lord, what is it going to take for us to touch heaven? Even in the midst of what people say, this was an outpouring, was just flat on our back, you know, the whole night. No. Well, that's good. I love to see people get healed. I love his presence. I love his glory. Whatever level or whatever dimension or expressions we have, the expressions of God's glory is here. But the reality of it is there's so much more. There's so much more joy. There's so much more love. There's so much more peace. There's so much more glory. There's so much more of an encounter. There's so much more of a heavenly vision. There's so much more of the realms of faith. There's so much more to all this miraculous interaction with the Holy Ghost. There's so much more to the reality of heaven striking our hearts so that we're captivated. There's so much more. And all we got to do is be willing to just be so caught away with Jesus. It's not about a bunch of things. Just caught away with Jesus. Oh, sticky mini up. Thank you, mighty God. Why don't you be seated? Let me minister to you a little bit. I want to try to matikina. I want to try to say that to Situni, see Pokoyana. I want to say, Retana Maki, Kiana Makea to Shapoti. By the Spirit of the Lord, declare unto you those things which Father has given to us and made resonant within the framework of His Word and within the framework of that which He is doing. And all we have to do is believe it and agree with Him. Now, there's going to be challenges to do that because there's all kinds of distractions, there's all kinds of ideas, there's all kinds of wants and wishes and plans and programs and commitments that we've made. That's a whole lot of stuff to climb over now to agree with God. That's a lot of adjustments in our lives. And I've discovered over and again that people would rather keep their commitments with man than keep the commitment with God. And that's really stupid. Why don't you just break trust with all men and just to trust God and commit with God? I mean, there's this thing you just had good people say, listen, you're just going to have to forgive me because I made a commitment to you. And in making my commitment to you, I broke covenant with God. And so I'm just going to have to get out of this one way or the other. You're just going to have to release me from it. And God will make it up to you. I'm going to walk with God. I'm going to know Him. I don't want to just know Him religiously. I don't want to know Him on Wednesday night. I want to shout in a hallelujah on Sunday morning. Oh, you know, hey, I praise God for what expressions there are in the earth today of those things that God has revealed in His Word. But when we look at what He wants and the magnitude of the way He wants to display His glory, then at the same time, there needs to be a great desperation within the hearts that says, Lord, what do I need to do to get this right? Because if we were on our jobs or if we were in other areas of life and we saw ourselves coming so short, so beneath the expectation, my goodness, we would do whatever we had to do to get it right. There's not a lot of people that are going to be happy just making a D. I mean, I passed. How did you? I D minus. How many did you get? All D minuses. But then the first thing that's going to happen is somebody's going to be encouraging you to get a tutor, to get some help, to be a little more time into studying, that you could bring that up to something average instead of just barely making it, Are you listening to me? And so that's what I'm going to talk to you tonight about. And I want you to turn in your Bibles to James chapter 1. Hallelujah. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to do my very best here tonight to just translate this for you directly from the Greek language. So my translation is going to sound a little bit different. I've just about got my translation of the Bible put in a form where I can read my translation, but I'm just going to start making a little bit of a transition for people because I want to challenge people. It's like, okay, Lord, they didn't hear it in the King James. They didn't hear it in the Amplified. They didn't hear it in the NIV. Perhaps they're going to hear if we say it in a different way. And then really, this is what I'm going to get at tonight. I'm going to get at a place of really you agreeing with God and making everything else unimportant to you. This is going to be challenging. It's going to be challenging. I guarantee it's going to be challenging. Because you got a lot of stuff on your plans. You got a lot of plans. You got a lot of ideas. You got a lot of movements, a lot of choices you make. I mean, it's about time people lock down with God and recognize He's not here, there, and yon. He's here. And there's a big difference between you going and doing your own will and doing His will. And doing His will is where you're going to find, where we're going to find a greater manifestation of His glory in this person. Listen, the world needs to see Jesus. The world needs to see Jesus. They don't need to see any more of you and me. They don't need to see any more religion. They need to see Jesus. And the only way the world's ever going to see Jesus is you're going to have to see Jesus. And I'm going to tell you right now, when you see Jesus, it's going to be something on the level of what happened with Paul. He fell down to the ground on the level of John. He fell before him as a dead man. I'm here to tell you, it's not going to be some little, you know, fantasy, you know. I'm talking about an encounter with Jesus that is going to result in a greater display of His glory and power through our lives. I'm not saying that there isn't something that you've already encountered and that there's not at this point a display of Jesus, but it needs to be much more. We want much more. I want much more. If you don't want much more, there's something seriously wrong with you. And if you being told that you need a whole lot more is discouraging to you, there's something seriously wrong with you. Because it'll already be the state of your heart. I want so much more. I'm so desperate for these things of God. I want to understand what it means to have received the gift of the holiness, still to walk in the gift of the holiness, because it's in the realm of holiness that there is going to be a greater revelation of His person to me. And before there's ever going to be a greater revelation of Jesus through me, there has to be a greater revelation of Jesus to me. And that's all began in a dimension of hunger. It's all begins in a dimension of thirsting. And God, the Holy Ghost, supplies us with that when we let Him. Well, we're getting filled with other things. Watch it. I tell you right now, start eating McDonald's and Twinkies. I guarantee you, and big sodas, and in no time at all, your appetite's going to be changed. And your physical responses to things are going to be changed too. And people live that way. I don't know how they do it. They do live that way, though. People live on junk food. Huh? Good food costs you more. Good food costs you more. Listen to me. There's a big spiritual application for you. Good food costs you more. I will just go with the poor food. Because the consequences aren't till much later. The immediate need is going to be satisfied. The growling stomach. Uh-oh. Just listen to me tonight, because God, the Holy Spirit's going to touch you. When we hold Jesus in His proper place, people, when we begin to hold Him in His proper place, then we'll begin to grow up into Him, into all things, who's supplying us with the ability to do so, which then we can supply to one another. And in that, that is the flow of the Holy Ghost that will rock the world. Anytime it's ever happened, it's always happened in small places, but anytime it's ever happened in some rural, remote place, huh? Like Wells and other places, it's changed the world. You have to decide what it is you're going to do. Are you going to make a plan that somehow, if I do these things, that God is going to be able to be glorified in Christ Jesus through my life? In absence of what God's simple plan is that's already been put forth. Because you can't do one, you can't do both of them. You're going to do one at the expense of the other. And we're just going to have to slow down here. And reevaluate and reassess what we've made important and how we're going about seeking God. And are we seeking Him according to the due order, due process? Because you don't go due process, it's thrown out of court, right? You got to do it right. It's just thrown out. Start over. Back to the queue. I'm tired of going back to the queue. I was in the wrong line again. I've been standing here for 30 years. I can't help it. You're in the wrong line. You're supposed to be in that other line. Well, I've been standing over here for 5 years. I can't help it. You're in the wrong line. Uh-oh. So finally we'll start reading and say, well, okay, wait a minute. What line am I supposed to be in? Line A? Now, line A is for those people who need immediate help. Line B, I got to read over here. Find out what line I'm, where I'm supposed to be waiting at, where I'm supposed to be seeking Him according to due process. How it is that I'm supposed to be going after these things in God. What things He's seeing, because His eyes look to and fro. He beholds the deeds of men, the works of men. Lo, there's not a word in my mouth that you know it all together. You see, you're wanting to show forth yourself mighty on our behalf. You're looking for somebody who's going to have the right responses in these tough situations and these challenging choices and these secret decisions that we can easily justify. The only way that you can be kept from self-deception is by the Word of God. And then I know something that's really more tricky than self-deception, and self-deception is a big one, man. Usually Satan just stands back and says, I don't need to do nothing. I mean, self-deception is pretty powerful. If self-deception ain't getting it done, he'll come in with some deceiving things because it's wide open. But oh man, when you begin to live by the word, when you begin to have a hunger, say, Lord, Jesus, I just want to know you. I want to win you. I want to see you. I want to be touched by you. I want this praise to be coming out of me. I mean, I don't need any help. I don't need CDs and turn the lights down and put on the incense. And I don't need a music worship band go around with me everywhere so that I could be in the atmosphere. I mean, there's a worship and a praise going on inside of me by the Holy Ghost that I give place to. And so therefore, there's nothing can distract me from that. I mean, people are going to have to get to a place where they find out just how much distraction is going on in your life. You want me to help you? Set an hour of prayer. And then you can find out how much distraction is going on in your life. Set a time where you worship him. Are you going to set aside to worship and just see how many distractions are coming at you? But should you do these things and begin to cry out to God because you want to know him, and it's not about religion, it's about a relationship. It's not about you self-justifying, about you being justified. It's not about, you know, some interest, some earthly interest. It's about a heavenly vision, a heavenly goal, a heavenly purpose. I'm telling you, people, everything changes. Everything begins to change. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody said, just another thing on our list to do. Your problem is you already got a bunch of earthly lists, and you already created your own list, and so now God's another addition to your list. What you need to do is you need to burn your list, and now you only got one thing on the list. Another thing on the list to do. Somebody said, you shouldn't preach so long, you're imposing upon people. They got to get up early in the morning. I said, I'm not imposing on anybody. They imposing on themselves. They need to forget about getting up in the morning. They need to reorganize their life around God, around seeking first the kingdom, around the fact that they're about to step from this life into the next life. And I'm telling you right now, heaven's too beautiful to miss. Huh? And hell is too terrible to go to. Hello. Yes. Come on now. But I'm going to say right now, heaven's too beautiful to miss right now. I mean, I'm in love with him right now. I want to know him now. I want to see him now. I read the Bible. I get so. God! I want this. Yes. I want this. Lord, what do I need to do? And I know what he wants. He wants us to allow the Holy Ghost to begin to develop within our life something that goes far beyond the natural things that we're all wrapped up in and compromised by. He wants us to begin to allow him to develop in our life in an unseen realm, a spiritual hunger, a spiritual interaction, a spiritual satisfaction, where ultimately all that we really value is being met in that place of worship and prayer and praise, because then there's a connectivity that goes on where we begin to now be opened up unto the Lord and being able to see and being able to receive now what's been going on all the time around us that we had no eyes to see or ears to hear, our heart to understand. Suddenly our eyes are open. Hallelujah. Yeah, and when this becomes no longer a fictional idea or something that's a little too complicated to get, and it becomes all you interested in, you're going to quickly step over into a realm where the heavenly vision is there, where interaction with the things of the Holy Ghost becomes so much more powerful and so much more impactful on your life than anything else you've been doing. And all you're going to do is go, I can't believe it took me so long. I cannot believe it has taken me so long. I have been so compromised. Things have been so convoluted in my life. And I want you to look at how simple the Lord makes it. And I love the way that James places it together here. So he says, because if any man is a hearer of the word and not a doer, this man... is like one who considers his natural face, in a mirror. Now, if you've been looking at yourself for a long time, you don't stare too long. You know what I'm saying? If you stared at yourself too long in the mirror, something's wrong with you. Right? if I was talking to you here tonight and you just kept seeing me doing this over here, you know.
Something's wrong with me.
Now, you go, you go into a third world country, some remote place. They never had any mirrors. Huh? You know what they're going to do? They're not going to stop looking at themselves. They're going to, for days, they're going to be looking at themselves in the mirror. They've never seen it. They're just captivated by it. But James opens up and says that, and he's talking about someone who hears the word of God but doesn't do the word of God. They hear what God says. They hear the announcement, you're an heir of God. Nothing's impossible for you. If you have a little bit of faith, you can say to this mountain. You begin to hear things about the glory the Father gave to me, I'm giving to you. You should receive power after that the Holy Ghost come upon you. And that is not a longing, and it's not something that you begin to just be captivated by and gaze at and continue to gaze at and look at and just overwhelmed by and captivated by until it becomes a living reality. Then what you are is like a person who beheld himself in the mirror and immediately forgot what he looked like. This is what James says. And it's really about how you and I interact with the Word of God. It's about how we read the Word of God, how we respond to the Word of God. We're just hearers of the Word, and we're not doers. It didn't produce the doing. You know, they came to Jesus and said, "But you know, blessed is the paps that gave you nourishment." He said, "No, blessed are those who hear the Word and do it." And that's where the blessing is, to hear the word of God and do it, to be captivated by it. The doing of it is something that the Holy Ghost produces within us because we're captivated by it. We want it. We don't live in a covenant where now we hear the word of God and we got to go by our own human effort and by our own bootstraps and somebody took the straps away and try to get it done. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
We're captivated by the word of God. Look at what God said about me. He said he purposed to reveal his son in me. And we're just staring at that and we're captivated by it. And we want that and we're looking upon it, gazing at it. Rather than just glancing, I left and I forgot what I looked like. What did I look like? Do I got black hair or blonde hair? Is my beard gray or what color is it? Do I even have a beard? Where's my nose at? Are you with me? Then he goes on to say, for he considered himself and has gone away. He considered himself, don't look too bad. Some people have more lofty things to say about themselves. Some people have more derogatory things to say about themselves. If you look in the mirror and you see that you don't look good, most people do something about it, right? Even me, I try. Most people do something about it. We don't get as much of a choice as women do. Women can go to the paints, and they can go to creating, you know. Men, all you can just grow facial hair, because there's no paints. He considers himself, and then gone away, immediately forgot what he looked like. But he says now, but there is another place of living. And honestly, James is not talking about he that got a hold of it and went with it out of a sheer discipline and human effort. He's talking about those people who are captivated by those things which God has declared concerning us. I'm going to take you there. This is where we're talking about people who are transfigured by thinking different about themselves. They beheld something in the Word of God. They heard what God said, and they believed what God said, and they were willing to be conformed to the image. They were willing to let everything that Father declared become that whom they see themselves to be. It redefines you and me. When you're redefined by God, nothing earthly matters to you anymore. None of the praises of men, none of the successes or whatever that you've accomplished or whatever skill set you have is of any meaning or any value. It's Paul saying, I've suffered the loss of everything and I count it but dung. It really is that. It's meaningless. I'm redefined. I'm part of a new race. I've been born again. I'm a new creation, possessor of the divine divine nature. I've been made the temple of God. The Holy Ghost lives here. God has given me an unlimited supply of His glory so that it should be being expressed through my life like rivers of His divine power and ability, so that I go everywhere driving out evil spirits, taking everything that is in front of me in possession to the kingdom of God. You redefined. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Physically, spiritually, materially, your purpose, everything. And so you start reading like this, and now, but he that looked into the perfect law of liberty, that's the complete law. See, the Greek word is teleos, and that particular word, Greek word here, it is in the form, teleon, and probably the best way to translate this particular form of the Greek word is to say complete, the complete law, because he's not going back to the Mosaic law. I don't care that Psalms 19 said the law of the Lord is perfect. He's not talking about Psalms 19. He's talking about the new covenant. He's a new covenant preacher. Somebody said, oh, it was still legal. He wasn't legal. He was New Testament, new covenant, born of the Spirit, brother to Jesus. Literally, Mary and Joseph's real son together. Hello. This is James's. He said, but he's talking about, this is complete. I mean, look, contrast it to the beauty of the law, the beauty of that which God inscribed with his finger on Mount Sinai, the power of it, the authority of it, that Father endued those who would take hold of it to be able to have a level, if you would, a sanctification, a gift of righteousness, a gift of holiness, so that he might dwell in their midst. But now look at the transforming word of God, the living word transforming me, working effectually in me, or transforming me, transfiguring me. Praise God. That's what the word of God does. He's talking about that word. And he says, but he that looks into the perfect law of liberty or freedom and continues in it. He continues to stare. Whoa! Look at me. Woo! Jesus! God the Father, Holy Ghost, new creation, divine nature, seated in heavenly places. Whoa! Heir of God, co-heir with. Woo! That's what we're doing here. See, we're captivated. We like a person in third world country. Look at me. We've never seen ourselves in a mirror. You can't just walk around looking at the mirror all the time. And you kind of look in with other people. It's like, you know, doing the selfies, but in the mirror. It's true. That's why back in the 1800s, they were able to trick people out of their gold and their diamonds, because they just give them a piece of brass to see a reflection of themselves in it. And they're like, whoa. It was a dim reflection that you see yourself in a piece of brass, but it was enough to say, to have all my gold, all my diamonds, just let me have this. Here we are. What are we looking at? I'm looking at the Word of God, and I'm seeing my reflection. I'm seeing who God says I am. It's now devaluating everything that everybody said about me and everything that I believed about myself, all the reports that have come down the pike over the years, all the things that would try to trash me right now. I can't even hear it. I'm like, whoa! Look at who I am. Look at what God's made me in Christ Jesus. Look at this. I got the glory He's got. Religion comes along and goes, religion hates union with God. Religion hates authority. You want to sort out a religious person? I'll tell you right, give them this book. I'm going to tell you right now, they will start foaming at the mouth. This one, religion, I'll start foaming at the mouth. Nobody can have the authority of God but God. No kidding. No kidding. But that's the first thing they're going to say. You start talking about the glory, start talking about faith, start talking about any dimension of authority and signs and wonders and miracles. Talk about any kind of oneness and union with God. And religion's going to come unglued, because Satan's going to come unglued, because he don't want you seeing that beauty and that splendor, because it's going to change you. It's going to redefine you. It's going to sort you out. The stuff that has been distracting you and holding you back isn't going to be valuable anymore.
Huh? You can't get my attention when I know that. That ain't value to me. That's not even important to me. Not at all interested. Huh? Anne's not at all interested in parachuting out of a plane. Has no meaning or no value. Huh? She's not at all interested in the zip line off of the big tall bridge there at the Zambezi. No interest. None of these things. No interest. All the stuff that captivates you and disinterested you and concerning you. What if it's no longer concern? I'm not concerned whether I live or whether I die. For me to live is Christ, to die is gain.
Yes.
What a great place to be in.
Yes.
Huh? Now, that's total abandonment. That's total abandonment. When you're willing to go there, everything else is small potatoes, as they say. It's meaningless. It's really nothing. Because I'm willing to make the ultimate sacrifice. The ultimate sacrifice is a blessing to me, in other words. The end of my life is a blessing to me. Hello. Marase. Huh? They that believe in him shall never see death. Woo! See, I never see death. Praise God. Uh-uh. When I close my eyes and breathe out my last breath, I'll see life. Yes. I won't go into death. Death has no sting. It has no power over me. My body is going to go lay down and just wait for my inner man. Hallelujah. It's going to be clothed upon with a tabernacle. And they're going to come back and get reunited one day, but I'll never see death. Praise God. I mean, how valuable is that to you? As you get older, it becomes more valuable. As you mature in the things of the Spirit, it becomes more valuable. It's true. He says somebody looks into this perfect, this complete law of liberty. The law of Christ. See, there's the law of Christ. There's the law of the Spirit. There's the law of faith. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All of those are great laws. That's the laws of the New Testament. It's the perfect or the complete law of freedom. He that the Son sets free is free indeed. We have been completely released. When I sit here and I gaze at this beauty, I see that sin and death has come to an end and has no power over me, that I'm in him and he's in me, and that he abides in me. And I mean, I abide in him. I dwell in him. I made my dwelling place. I'm going to live there. I'm not moving out. I like staying there all day long. I dwell in him, and his word dwells in me. God wants to bring you to a place where you quit processing out of your own thoughts and you quit asking everybody for their opinion. Yes. Hallelujah. Yes. He wants you to start processing by the Word of God and let the Holy Ghost speak to you. Amen. Praise God. Come on now. Yes. It's a terrible thing. God's children walk around like a bunch of larvas. What do you think about me? Oh, what do you think about me? What do you think I should do? What do you think I should do? Fifth opinion. What do you think I should do? And fathers are like, will there be any faith when I come? Who seeks me? And he's watching us because we're being challenged all the time. We're being sorted out all the time. The wind of the Spirit sorts us out. For the good purpose. Father is for a good purpose, trying our heart through many different kinds of trials and tribulations and challenges and situations that come out. People, it's about time we get the right response so that the challenges on that level can come to an end. It says we rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory, having received the end of our faith. Unless we're in many different types of tribulations right now, fiery trials, because it's needed for the trying of our faith, because we're still all distracted and all compromised and all entangled with all these other ideas about ourselves and opinions about where God is. He's right here. Behold, he's here in the midst of us. I mean, he protects us when we don't deserve it. And then some people just think that is, oh, look, that's just proof that I'm everything acceptable. Well, you are everything acceptable. He's made you everything acceptable, but he's not made you everything that he wants you to. You're not letting him make you everything that he wants you to be so that he can fully use you and reveal his son through you. But in his mercy and grace, he protects us. In his mercy and grace, he gives provision. It's all his mercy and grace. He saved us by mercy and grace. He helps us by his mercy and grace. He delivers us by mercy and grace. He provides for us whatever we're willing to believe. Amen. You think about
circumstances and situations that have come along in your life that have caused you to redefine God's word. So someone that you love got sick. So now you rewrote the scripture and you now have a doctrine that says not everyone gets healed. Yeah, that came out of your experience. Or somebody you really liked a whole lot, and you can't believe their experience, and you say, well, could you please show me where that verse of scripture is so I can stare at that for a while? Not everybody gets healed. Because you let your experience, you say, but my experience. And then you know, you find yourself constantly falling because you into sin, falling into some kind of an addiction because you've never really taken a hold of that growth and that maturity. You live in the mercy of God. Listen to me. You can live in the mercy of God, but you don't have to constantly be there, constantly being beat up by the devil and deceived by the devil. But ultimately what happens is you come to a conclusion that we're going to sin more or less every day. Where's that one at so I can stare at that for a while? And then there, you're rewriting the Bible, man. You're rewriting the Bible. You're rewriting the Word of God based upon your experiences, based upon your discouragement, based upon your disappointments, based upon events that look contrary to the Word of God. I'm fixed. If all of you die right now, I still believe that everybody's supposed to be healed. If all of you are a killer or die right now, some kind of disease and sickness, I still say Jesus heals every time. Why? Because that's what the Bible says. That's what the Word of God says. I can't sort out the rest. I can hear what He said. I don't know what was going on in the dynamics of these different people's lives. Oh, Holy Joe, he was the best, holiest, wonderfulest man I ever knew. Loved God more than anybody ever loved God, and he died of cancer. And so now the Scripture is redefined for us. Now we've got to add another verse because of Holy Joe and how he was. So wonderful and perfect. And he died of cancer. No. See, if you stay fixed on the Word of God, something happens. See, if you stay fixed upon the Word of God, you look into the complete law of liberty or freedom, and you continue to look. See that? And you continue to look. You continue to look. Now, you're not a forgetful here because you're continuing to look. Now, what did you just say about that? Sin more or less every day? I'm looking here. I don't see that. What did you say about Jesus don't heal every time? I'm looking here. I don't see that. I'm continuing to look. I'm not a forgetful here. But I now, because I'm constantly gazing upon what he says, I'm a doer of the work. Yes. Now, this one is blessed in his doings in every way. Now, what are we talking about? Blessed in his doing. We're talking about the blessings of God upon you. What is the blessing of God upon you? It's the divine ability to have everything that he said you're supposed to have and to be everything you're supposed to be and living out the heavenly dream. Okay? Now, would you turn with me to a verse of scripture, a very similar verse of scripture to this one. And it's found in 2 Corinthians, not 2 Chronicles. I'll get myself in the right covenant here in a minute. 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 18. Now listen to me, dear people. There is not a single person in this place who should have some kind of veil of deception over them where they can't see the reality of this. Because the reality of it, here's what goes on. When you begin to look at the new covenant and you see the transformation that has taken place where you and I were made a new creation, where you and I have made one with the Lord Jesus Christ, where he's in us and we're in him, and in that there is liberty. There is a freedom that you've not known. There's a freedom to where Satan can't get a hold of you like he did before. Where harassment and doubt and disappointment can't discourage you at the last moment when God was about ready to do the work, where all of a sudden now you have enough of a relationship and confidence that having done all to stand, you stand because you know what God says is going to happen. You're not going to weary in well doing because he's faithful to his promise. All the promises of God are yea and amen. Amen. Hello. Amen. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Looky here. There's not a single person that ought to have blinders on their eyes. And if those blinders are on your eyes here tonight, we want to remove that thing off of you. We don't want you to walk around with a religious veil over your face where you can't see the glory of the new covenant. Hallelujah. And you know, when you start reading 2 Corinthians chapter 3, I was talking to someone today and they said, well, we've been teaching people about the new man and now everybody hates us. I said, you know what? That's something good to be hated for. I said, you just go ahead and just rejoice in being hated for teaching people about the new man. Praise God. Yeah. You know, but what also is very important is that you live the new man, because the reality is when you're looking in the mirror, there's supposed to be a countenance change. There's supposed to be something on your face. There's supposed to be something in your eyes, in your heart, in your mouth, in your conduct, in your behavior, in the manner of the way you live, the way you speak. I was sitting in a room full of preachers one night, and I was just being me. And somebody said something, and I come at doubt and unbelief with every weapon I had on me. And I just started pulling stuff out right, left, and center, man. You know, it's like one of those movies where a person got to be disarmed, and by the time they get finished, they got a pile of guns and weapons. I started pulling every word of God out, man, coming at that doubt and unbelief, letting people understand that Jesus is present. He is who he says he is. He'll do what he said he'll do. He's the healer, same healer today as he was then. I'm not going to talk about another Jesus. I'm not going to let you defame him. I'm telling you he's here. And someone said to me after we left that room, they said to me, Your faith is very attractive. It is attractive. It is beautiful. Hallelujah. The Word of God, yeah, the Word of God is what's got us all dressed up looking good up here. Hallelujah. Both the living Word and the written Word. Hallelujah. He beautifies the meek with salvation. Because why? The meek is going to be just spouting out his word. Hallelujah. Just living by his word, declaring his word. This way it's going to be. Well, it ain't going to be that way. Oh, yeah, it's going to be that. Might not be that way for you. I tell you what, I said to one preacher, I said one night, I said, you have faith to be sick, and I'm going to have faith to be healed. Amen. Yeah. And he goes, that ain't fair. That's not fair. I said, wait, no, man. You trying to make me like you, and I'm not going to be like you. And you obviously aren't going to listen to me, so I'm just telling you, let's end it here. You have faith to be sick, I'm going to have faith to be healed. Well, that ain't fair. That ain't fair, because you put yourself over in a better category than me. Ha-ha, I'm in a better category than you. I'm speaking the word of God. You not. You're declaring after your own experiences, after your own discouragements, after your own disappointments, after your own life experiences. I'm telling you what cannot. I'm telling you what's fixed. I'm telling you what God watches over to perform. I'm telling you what's forever settled in heaven and earth. God's word. That's going to be sorted out in our lives. And sometimes the heat gets pretty hot. The battle gets pretty strong. The situation gets pretty sticky. Pretty devastating. You got to understand how to stand in the word. Be fixed. Now we look at this beautiful scripture here. Speaking of the allegory that's already been set up about how Moses' face had to be veiled. Because people didn't want to look at what that glory on his face, because literally they were having to look at the new covenant. They were having to look on his face and see, ha, the law of sin and death is going to be abolished. The law is going to be completely annulled and put away with, because Father is going to come and he's going to destroy the power that Satan has held over us and kept us separated from God. Father is going to come and destroy the separation so that we're going to be one and our face is going to be lit up like his. Because he's going to live in us and abide in us. And that's what 1 Corinthians chapter 3, 2 Corinthians chapter 3 is about. So what does Paul say? He says, but we all with uncovered faces, unveiled faces. We don't got a veil. Praise God. People come in with a veil. Get that thing off you. trying to be all holy. God made you holy with another kind of covering. Hallelujah. It's the covering of the Holy Ghost. Praise the name of the Lord. But we all with all unveiled or uncovered faces, the glory of the Lord behold in a mirror. The same image. Now, that's just reading it in the way it would flow in the Greek language. And so we would say, but we all with unveiled faces or uncovered faces behold the glory of the Lord in a mirror. When you look in a mirror, who do you see? Oh, come on, give me a break. This is not a trick question. When you look in the mirror, who do you see? You. When I look in the mirror, I see me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When I look into the mirror of the Word, when I look in the mirror of the Word and I look at my reflection and what the Word describes me to be, I go, wow, I see Jesus. I've been made like unto Him. I'm in fashion and a new creation. I'm in Him. He's in me. Christ is in me. He's come to live and dwell on the inside of me by His Spirit. Hallelujah. I no longer live. I am dead. My life is hid with God in Christ. And Christ is my life. Hallelujah. Well, if you don't stay fixed looking at the Word in the complete law of liberty, if you don't stay fixed just looking there, you're going to see yourself as other people see you, as you situations would dictate you to be, huh? But if you just keep gazing at yourself in the mirror of the perfect law of liberty, you won't be like a natural man who beholds his face in the mirror and forgets what he looks like and then ultimately end up being a hearer only and not a doer. It takes you looking continually to see who God made you, what He describes you to be, what He's empowered you to be, so that you can ultimately be a doer, because it's the empowerment of the Word that produces the faith, the outworking of the divine power of God, where it's not by might and it's not by power, but it's by my Spirit, says the Lord. Where it becomes a living Word, transfiguring you, hallelujah, transforming you, working mightily on the inside of you. I am what I am, said I am, so I am. That's a done deal, hallelujah. And when you don't give Satan any wiggle room and you grow in faith and he prepares you unto every good work and he prepares you unto every battle you have to fight, sickness comes along and you defeat it. Death comes along and you defeat it. Huh? All these other things come along and you defeat it. Praise God. Why? Because now it isn't something about your mind. It's an activation of faith. It's an activation of faith. Huh? One day I walked in Geneva's room. She laid there dying. I'm telling you, she was laying there dying. But as soon as I walked in the room, they asked me to come over and pray for her. I said, well, you got enough prayer to pray. You got enough faith to pray. You're fine. No, come over. So I come over. I'm just like, you know, just like anything else, being just any other day and feeling about any other way you would normally feel. But as soon as I walked in the room, I grew 40 feet tall. And I was in charge. In the Spirit. Not something I created in my mind. Not something that I try to perform. Not something that I try to make up. But by the Spirit of the living God, a place where I lived and available now to be empowered by Him. So I walked in there and said, don't worry, I got you. See, not out of the realms of just my own mental thought, my mental ideas and grandiose ideas about who God made me to be and who He said I am, but by a living reality of relationship with Him, a faith that He is able to activate in me anytime He's ready to use me in that way. Hallelujah. And I want Him to be able to use me in that way all the time. I want to just live every day like somebody that's right out of the book of Acts. Hallelujah. Because that book of Acts has not been fully written yet. It will be recorded at the end of this age. Hallelujah. I'm not condemnation. I'm going to be in the book of Acts. Huh? I might be one of those people that the Lord said there was one person down there left saying during this. There's one guy standing up. He did not let up on those things which I described in my word, even though he seen it, may have not seen it in the way that it was described. Never did he dilute it or never did he lower the bar, but spoke it just like I said it, even in the midst of every kind of opposition. This is who we need to be. Yes. If you're being persecuted for righteousness' sake, you're in a good position. Amen. You got the blessing of the Lord on you. Amen. You're being persecuted for what God said in His Word, not some minor doctrine that you just all out of sorts over, want to argue with everybody about. It's one thing you never do is argue over the Word of God. People arguing over the Word of God, entering into a demon spirit of strife. arguing over sinless perfection while they're yielding to a demon spirit of strife. Give me a break. You know what I'm saying to you? Come on, man. Jesus, help us. It's about time we come alive in understanding and knowledge and in wisdom in Christ Jesus. Yeah. Praise God. So here we are, looking with an unveiled face at the glory of the Lord. Huh? When Moses looked at the glory of the Lord, what happened? He lit up. What is the lighting up? It is a token or a sign or an emblem of the transfiguration. You with me? Yes. And then there's a word here. This word here is metamorpho. See, it's almost like, you know, kung fu. Are you with me? Say metamorpho. Metamorpho. It's first found in Matthew chapter 17 and verse 2. And it speaks of when Jesus was transfigured before them, began to shine with the radiant light of divine glory. That word is used several different times in the New Testament, and this is one of the places that it's used, that when we stand there, here, when we stand there, beholding the glory of the Lord, and we look in the mirror, we see this glory of the Lord with an unveiled face. Here's Moses. And he goes, walks up to the mirror, just see Moses. He's got his face veiled, right? Because nobody can look at him. Veil your face. They said, we're going to die. We'll die. This is the legend. It's not written in scripture like this, but the legend, if you would, the folklore, the tradition is that if anybody looked at his face, they fell over dead. Okay? They're not going to die. They're going to just get, they might get a bit, you know, blinded by the sunlight of his face. Literally, S-O-N, light of his face, because that's what it was. Yes. Mm-hmm. But imagine Moses, he walks over, he takes off the veil, he looks in the mirror. What is he beholding? He's beholding the glory that came upon him as he beheld the glory of the Father. He was transfigured. He began to shine. And he shone till he died. Wow, I want that. I want some of that. I'm like, God, are you hearing me? Yeah. Like, ah, I want to sing another song. I mean, it's pretty and everything, but ah, God, I want you. I want that. What I got to do to have that? I know it's supposed to relax and everything, not try so hard, but I got to have that. Well, that's what was going on in Moses when he got that. Hello. There was a hunger there. I got to have that. God, have mercy on me. I'm here with all these people. I want you. That's what he said. I'm not interested in a land flowing with milk and honey and all these riches and all these fame. I'm going to stay right here on this rock with you. I want you more than all that other stuff. See, it redefines you. It redefines you. Men will define you. They'll tell you what you got to do, what you got to be in order to be everything that men want you to be. What they call success as they die and go into an eternity without God, as they've lived under the oppression of demon spirits, and in many cases, the possession of demon spirits all their life. All the time, there's the voice of the Lord calling us to come into the beauty of His presence, to come into a place where we live forever. Hallelujah. Where we experience the life forever. And the quality of the life is better than the quantity of the life, but both are good. Just being in His presence, being captivated by Him. This is what God's calling us to be. He wants us to get hungry. He wants to stir us up. He wants us to redefine for ourselves. He wants us to get it in our head. I can't even get people to like me on my Facebook or retweet my sermons. I'm writing things on Facebook that nobody else is even talking about, and I can't even get anybody to reshare those. How am I going to get you to remember how you're supposed to behave when you come into the meeting? I'm at a loss. I'm at a loss of how to get you to participate with the gospel. I'm at a loss. You got to figure it out for yourself. You got to get into the Word of God until something starts stirring on the inside of you. And nothing is important to you but Jesus and an encounter with Him. And suddenly church becomes about Jesus. It's not about religious activity. It's not about song. It's not about sermons. It's not about the social club and all the other stuff we want to make it. It's about an encounter with Jesus, because that's what He made it. He put it in His church as an encounter with Him. He placed in His church the glory and the power. He caused it to reside there. When He poured out the Holy Ghost and fire upon it, so that the church itself might fully reveal the very person of Jesus, so that Jesus Christ might stand right there in the midst of the place. Jesus said, lo, I am with you every day until the end of the age. That's what he said. The last thing he said, really, it's a summation of the gospel. And the last thing, one of the last things he said, which you would read in Matthew chapter 28. What is it, verse 20 or 21? Every day. My concern is, how much are we ignoring him? How much are we unthoughtful of him? Because we quit gazing at the word. We quit gazing at the beauty and the glory. There's nothing more beautiful than seeing Jesus. It takes all of this that we're talking about to a whole nother level. And somebody said, oh, you're focusing on you. I'm not focusing on me. I'm focusing on what he's done for me. And I'm focusing on what he's done for me has now allowed me to focus on him greater than any religious person could ever focus on him. Because you're going to have to receive that which he's freely given before you're ever going to have more of a revelation of him. As long as you have doubt and unbelief and sitting over there sorted out and separated from God and something lower than a, you know, a worm's belly. You're never going to, you're always going to be a hearer, never a doer. You're never going to know the way out of captivity and bondage. You'll never know the perfect liberty, the perfect law of liberty. You'll never know the glorious liberty of the sons of God. You'll never know the liberty of the Holy Ghost that is talked about here in this verse and in the very next verse. He says, there we stare at the glory. It's like Moses staring, seeing the glory. Come on. And maybe we don't get to see it right now, literally. I want to see it literally. So you can't have that. No, you can't have that. I can have it. Moses had it. God's no respecter of Moses. I can have it. Jesus had it. He said, these works which I do, these works which I do, shall you do them more numerously. And I think that I really need to start making that point more, people, just so that none of these naysayers and gainsayers and, you know, liars can say something different, you know. Because truly, there is no greater work than the work of salvation, so no one could do a greater work than Jesus did when it comes to salvation. But he wasn't talking about, and that wasn't the application of the context. He was talking about the quality and kind of works that he was doing in terms of signs, wonders, and miracles. For the deliverance of the people, to destroy the works of the devil, how that God anointed him with the Holy Ghost and power, who went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him, kind of works. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the name of Jesus. This is who we are. This is who we're supposed to be. We're supposed to be this naturally. If I stand in front of somebody trying to hand them some of our Mission Training Center beef, they'll come under they'll start laughing under the Holy Ghost. Because I am who I am, especially when people aren't all, you know, knotted up about something going to happen. Trying so hard. Maybe just relax. Just say, here. I'm just in my pajamas in the morning with my hair messed up and my breath bad. And the power of God is here. It's present. And sometimes people, less guarded as they are in church, you know what I'm saying, got you off guard, man, you get slammed in the anointing. It's happened to me many, many times. Watch people get slammed and anointed. Wow, I wish you could receive like that in church. You're all bottled up when you get church, aren't you? You know why? Because the prince and the power of the atmosphere doing everything you can do to stop the glorious church from being revealed. It's trying to distract, trying to make it about other things than what it's supposed to be, where Christ Jesus, the head, is not being held in his proper place. Where the person of Jesus Christ is not being adorned. Where he's not being worshipped. And saw it as the only thing we're interested in here. Not interested in anything else. Not any other thing that comes as a result of seeking Jesus, praise God. In fact, the more we're seeking him, all the stuff starts happening then. Hallelujah. All the stuff starts happening. Not just some portions of it. Hallelujah. The whole gospel starts taking place. I don't want just part gospel. I want the whole gospel. Huh? I don't want just joy. I want miracles too. Hallelujah. Praise God. I don't want just healing. I want tongues and interpretation of tongues. I want the whole thing. Huh? I don't just want the 9 gifts. I want all the gifts. Amen. I want everything that Jesus is doing. Praise the name of the Lord. It's about time, dear people. Look, God, Father's waiting. He wants to move in our lives in a greater way. So we've got to finally come to a place where we're saying, okay, Lord, search me. I want to just be that much more adjusted. I want to be just that much more in that place where you can do whatever you want to do. We're Holy Spirit. We're not singing our own songs. We're not preaching our own sermons. We're not praying our own prayers. We're being moved by you, Lord. We've given ourselves over to a place of yielded to you. That's why the baptism of the Holy Ghost is so essential. because there's nothing that causes you to be in to yield to the Holy Spirit as that wonderful realm of the utterance of the language of the Spirit that He gave to the church in the first place for the same purpose. Somebody said, you talk too fast. Well, I got it on tape. Read it. Listen, rather, to it. And besides that, I'm going to tell you right now, my speedy speaking is going right to your spirit anyways. Yes. Amen. Hallelujah. And it's obvious to me that ain't nobody gonna remember nothing that said. That's it. All of a sudden, you start getting fixed at looking at this Word of God. You start adoring the living Word and the written Word, where you meditate on it or you recite it day and night, where it doesn't depart out of your mouth. Hallelujah. For the word of faith is nigh you in your heart and in your mouth, so that you may do it. Come on now. Come on now, dear people. And there, staring in the mirror, beholding the glory of the Lord. See, Moses, he took the veil off. Okay? Hallelujah. You looked at the Word of God, the glory's come upon you because you've been made a new creation. You take the veil off. You're sitting there staring in the Word of God, and you're seeing the glory of the Lord on you just like it was on Moses, but even greater, because that's what 2 Corinthians chapter 3 already established, if you read it. But you're looking even greater. You're going, wow! You're just being blown away by this radiant power of Almighty. There you are changed into His image. Look at that. You are transfigured, metamorpho. It's one of the other times. Metamorpho. Say metamorpho.
Metamorpho.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I was sitting in a room one night with a bunch of preachers, and so I just came out with a Greek word, you know, like metamorpho, and I was going to make a point on some Greek word. And everybody got hit by the anointing. They thought I was speaking in tongues. I'm not kidding you. But woo, power of God, what was that? I said, I was just going to make a point about a Greek word. No, the Word of God is powerful, dear people. If I can keep, I've done this over and over again. If I can catch people off guard, the anointing will string right into you. Listen to me. I'm not joking with you. We're trying our best to get you to relax and take the guard down. Quit trying to be somebody. Start getting captivated with Jesus. You won't care about who you are ever again. Amen. That's really what all self-denial is really about anyways. Coming to realize, get out of the way, get out of the way, get out of the way. You are dead. That's getting out of the way. Your life is hid with God in Christ. That's completely getting out of the way. And Christ, who is your life? That's out of the way. And we don't want to get out of the way. Oh, I'm a bad person. Oh, I messed up. Oh, I'm so stupid. Oh, I'm this. Oh, I can't get it. Every time I start to have a prayer time, you know, I either fall asleep or forget. That's definitely an F. You know what I'm saying? You just get up and you make the time again. Until you quit falling asleep and forgetting. Well, I did it for a week and then I stopped. It's like New Year's resolutions. They last like, how many, average New Year resolution?
3 weeks.
Huh? 3 weeks. That's it. That's the height of human discipline, human effort. God, the Holy Ghost, wants to come in and fill us with the motivation. Hallelujah. 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 Saw a little picture the other day. Said how fast you can run in the morning is based upon the motivation. And there was a bear behind the guy. Yeah, that's really motivating. That's an outside motivation. Father's put an inside motivation on the inside right here. Why don't you get hungry for the inside motivation? Somebody said, I can't find any good thing in me. You need to get saved. Because Christ Jesus wants to come and live and abide on the inside of you. Holy Ghost wants to come live on the inside of you. He wants to put such a good thing on you, it comes out of you like living, like gushing rivers of living water. That's a huge good thing. Come on, people. We're going to have to quit believing the lies and start believing the truth.
Amen.
He says, as you stand there looking in the mirror, taking it, hooking it up with what James said in James 1:25, staring, gazing in the perfect law of liberty, looking at the things that God said about you, beholding in that what he said about you when he made you a new creation, created again, a renewed in righteousness and true holiness, recreated just like what he wanted, with all the splendor therewith. His glory having received, seeing, having, you're now looking at yourself, at the Word of God, gazing at yourself at the complete law of liberty, radiating with the glory of God, there, looking at that, beholding what God has said about you, embracing it, seeing it, accepting it, receiving it, there you are changed into his image. There you are transfigured. You literally transfigured. You get yourself a transfiguration going. Now you're going to really light up. Hello. By the Spirit, you're transfigured by the Spirit of the Lord. And once again, the other big time that this is used in the Scripture is there in Romans chapter 12 and verse 2. And it says, be not conformed to this world. When you're fixed on who God says you are in a heavenly realm, the world is going to lose all of its value. It's going to lose all of its meaning. When you've had an encounter that has redefined your life, it's going to be no problem. Be not conformed to this world, but be transfigured, metamorpho, once again. Be transfigured by the renewing of your mind, proving what is that good and perfect and acceptable will of God. Are you listening to me? Yes. Father's called you and I, Romans chapter 8 and verse 29, to be conformed to the image of the Son. How am I going to be conformed to the image of the Son? Just described it. Just simply described it. Because you're going to believe what God said in his word about you. And when every challenge and when every test and when everything comes at you that says, nay, it's not so, you're not what God described you to be. You stand there faithfully in God's word, not even being able to hear what anybody else is saying. Everybody's coming with their mirrors and say, look in my mirror what you look like. Yeah, and it's like that at the circus, you know, all those crazy looking mirrors. Look at my mirror. Look at your big old nose in my mirror, because your nose is sticking out about this far, right? Your eyes are recessed and narrow. Look at what you look like in my mirror. You're not looking at anybody. You're looking at my mirror over here. I'm looking at what Father says about me. I'm not interested in your mirrors, anybody else's mirrors. Hallelujah. Havosikana ishi. Hashiyana kushiyana matapia. And when we just bring this all to a place that Satan, you know, Satan can't fight against this, what I'm saying, if you're preoccupied with him all day long. But when you're preoccupied with other stuff, you can't hear. It's like, did he say anything? Yeah, he's been talking for a long time. What'd he say? Because you're captivated with something else. You spent all your energy on something else today. Something else got the best of you. There's nothing left over for God. He's going to get whatever, you know. Most of it's going to be screensaver. And tomorrow morning, you're going to get up and you're just going to repeat your same thing. You're going to go round and round, grinding meal for the Philistines. Hair cut off, eyes gouged out. Huh? Hair cut off, proving that you lost your anointing. Eyes gouged out because you lost it. Laboring. Who's tired of going round and round, grinding meal for the Philistines? Who's tired of living their own life? Who's tired of screaming and hollering, getting upset because they didn't have their way, because they never grew, spiritually, they never grew up past 3 years old? I used to know this preacher. He'd start out the meeting with a baby screaming. Wah! And went on for like about 2 minutes. Then he turned it off and started preaching. What is it going to take for the church to grow up? The Lord did a great work with that, actually. Everything I'm describing to you and everything I'm discussing to you in the Word of God results in one thing. You being captivated with Jesus. It just all works. All this has one impact, has one effect. All of a sudden you become so hungry for Jesus. You begin to live it out every day. You hit the church meeting. The church now, because you're living in that, you begin to understand what the church is. The church isn't about songs. The church isn't about preaching. The church isn't about storytelling, nursery, babysitting, this thing, that thing, the other thing. Time to catch a quick nap. A place where you get disappointed and discouraged because there wasn't a motivational speaker telling you how wonderful you are. And how you certainly can do it if you just try a little harder. Just believe in yourself more. Somebody said, I'm never going to go to church over there again. All they ever do is correct us. Amen. And it's just so discouraging. So that's just it. The instruction of the Lord has no place to work. And we're going to have to be willing to invite the Holy Ghost to come and lead us and instruct us and correct us. We're going to have to invite the Lord. Because why? We behold something so glorious and so beautiful that we want every dimension, and we're so become so captivated with who the person of Jesus. He's not aloof from us anymore. He's with us every day unto the end of the age. And say the end of the world. It's literally the end of the age. Hallelujah. Because the church age is about to go away, and a new age is going to begin. And that age is the resurrected saints gathered around him, seeing him as he is, for we should be like him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And everybody who has this hope purifies himself, even as he is pure. And what are we purifying ourselves from? The distractions. When he said, don't be conformed to the world, but be transfigured, what is he saying? You get one or the other. You're either going to be all wrapped up in this worldly stuff and in your worldly pursuit for all your worldly reasons, and you never increase anointing. If I'm involved in something that is taking away from the anointing increase in my life, you know how quickly I'm going to get rid of it? As quickly as I recognize it. Yes. Amen. I'm talking to every single person in this place. So if you think I'm talking to you about you, you are absolutely right. And if you don't think I'm talking about you, you are absolutely wrong. I'm talking to every single person. He's talking about me, fits everybody here tonight. As far as I'm concerned, he's talking about me, fits everybody every single night. And there's only one way that the anointing increases in our life. We increase with the increase of God as a simple result of our hunger and thirst for the things concerning the person of the Lord Jesus, because that's what the Holy Spirit is doing. That's what Father God is doing. Hallelujah. That's going to make the difference for every lost and dying person on the planet. There's one, I heard today, there's 1.25 billion Muslims. 1.25 billion Muslims are on the way to hell without Jesus. And I'm not interested in shutting them out and keeping them. I'm not scared of them. I'm interested in getting them in. I'm interested in, and I know what it's going to take. It's going to take a radical revelation of Jesus. And you and I can't be distracted and preoccupied with all this other stuff and say it's going to happen. Because I'm going to tell you right now, because you're going to be in this pursuit, somehow you're going to be used by God doing this stuff that has nothing to do with anything. God is giving you no authority in his word to do it. And you're going to find yourself 60 years old going, oh, I'm going to do this. No, you're not going to ever do it. I mean, you're going to be, by the time you're 60, you know, you're now in the last leg of, you pulled in everything you got here, so you can't really, probably not going to pull out now and start doing what's right. You're going to spend the last 10 years of your life doing nothing. Wood, stubble, hay, poof, burned up, nothing. At the expense of another generation passing, because there was no one. Those who finally was willing to step in, they got distracted with other interests. Huh? You listen to me now. Yes. Father, we just ask you to forgive us. Yes. It's so easy to get right with God. All you got to do is humble yourself and repent. Just say, Father, forgive us. We want to modify your word. We want to rewrite your word. No man has any authority unless he receives it from heaven. It has to be written in the word for us to be able to do it. By what authority do you do these things? The Word of God itself from Him gives us the authority to do what He's purposed us to do. If you cannot find what you're doing written in the Word of God, if you cannot find what you're being written in the Word of God, if you cannot find what you're living written in the Word of God, I'm challenging you tonight to repent and get right with God and forsake the thing and get yourself over into the kingdom of God and start pursuing things that are going to last and things that are eternal. Amen. Quit playing make-believe. Hello. Yes. I mean, you need to see yourself. Every single one of God's people need to see themselves buying a one-way ticket to the mission field.
Amen.
Whether it's the domestic mission field or whether it's an international mission field, your life needs to be about that. Yes. If what you're doing, there's no place for Jesus in it, then you shut it down. You can prove it real quick. Just write Jesus across your forehead. Hallelujah, so to speak. Amen. Just start being who you are in God. Start praising the name of the Lord. Thank God. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. It's wonderful while they're cussing and doing whatever it is they're doing. Father told me to glorify Him in my body and my spirit. I'm telling you right now, I'm going to just listen and I'm going to lay it down to you. I don't believe there is not a one shred of evidence that says that sickness or disease glorifies Jesus at all. In fact, the Word of God describes just the opposite. I'm not having it. I'm not going to get on the side of that stuff. I'm going to purpose myself to be what God's described me to be. Because I know that that's what He's doing, and if I agree with Him, He'll do it in me, and the results will be His. We'll be God-made people. And your kids need to be in here. The children need to be in here. It's just crazy. It's nuts. I wouldn't have stood for it for a minute. Maybe you're going for a different result. Because I know how this works. I know how it works. You get in the Word, you get saturated by the Word, and you're going to be changing. You get in the things of the Spirit, you stay saturated by the things of the Spirit, and you're going to change. Otherwise, I don't know what's going to happen to you. I don't know what those results are going to be. And what everybody does is they make believe that their results were all designed and fashioned by God, and the Lord did it, and I'm His and He's mine. And it's just not even the Word of God. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
And I'm saying that to every single person, every parent in this place tonight. There's no reason for your children not to be in here. There's no reason for 2, 3, 4, 5-year-old kids being up in the nursery. There's no reason for that. Just they need to be in the meeting. My children were, sometimes by this time at night, they were laying on the bed. They were laying, sleeping. Because I had my house in order. Because I demanded it. So they say, well, and you find out what you're going to fight your battles over. Because I made up my mind what I was going to fight my battles over. Everybody's going to listen to me. So they said, oh, well, that's controlling. No. It's not controlling. That is absolutely commanding it to be God's way. To have authority. And Abraham, that's what God said to Abraham. Abraham, I know that you will command your children after you. He said it to Moses as well. Will he say it to you? Are you listening to me, people? Get your house in order, beginning with you. Get yourself submitted to the Lord Jesus Christ. Get yourself in the Word of God. Make sure that everything passes the Word test. That's the acid test, the Word test. Does it pass the Word test? Huh? Get yourself doing what's right. Understand the Word of God describes what women are supposed to do. Ask my wife. She wrote a book on it. Because the Word of God describes what the woman is supposed to be doing in the house. Hallelujah. You want to write your own book? You're going to get your own results. You listen to me. You're just going to have to understand it. People don't want to hear it. They want to do whatever the age is telling them to do. They want to do whatever the culture is telling them to do. They want to be whatever, you know, the popular opinion says to be and says to do. I was talking to Joe the other day. I said to Joe, I said, you know what? I said, it's amazing to me how people just stand there and try to worship Jesus with a song that was written by somebody who had a guitar in one hand, beer in the other hand, just got finished snorting cocaine. I said, I can feel it as soon as he starts singing. And Joe said, I can feel it too. I feel the same thing. I can feel it. People are so caught away and their own opinion and their own idea of things. They're so aloof from the anointing and the reality, the presence of the person of God. They've never really grown and matured in the things of what Father has said. It's because they've allowed themselves to grow and mature in the things that men have said, the opinions of men. They've allowed themselves to grow and mature in religion. They've not allowed themselves to grow and mature in the manifest presence. And you want to be of a different sort, dear people. I'm here tonight to tell you, you want to be of a different sort. We want everything to be about Jesus. We want the joy and the rejoicing to be about Jesus. Amen. We want the deep meditative prayer and song to be about Jesus. We want the longing of the heart, the passions of the heart, the celebration of the heart, the intercessions of the heart, everything. We want it to be about Jesus. We want to be our motivation when we wake up in the morning. We want it to be about Jesus. We say, Holy Spirit, lead me and guide me. You know what he's going to be doing? He's come to reveal Jesus. It's his whole purpose to come reveal Jesus, to take everything that belongs to Jesus and make it known to us, to take everything that belongs to the kingdom of heaven. Because I'm going to tell you right now, anything that's going on in the kingdom of the earth has no meaning, no value in the kingdom of God. No meaning, no value, none. None. That's what Father says. Our only purpose, the only reality, the only life that you and I need to be living is the one that Jesus defined for us so that we can make a difference in where people are going to spend eternity, because people are breaking the barrier every moment, every day. Hundreds of thousands of people, literally millions upon millions of people, are waking up in hell every single day. I don't remember exactly what the statistic was on exactly how many people are dying every day, but it was huge, the total number of people that die every second, that die every minute, that die every day. A world going into eternity without God. Somehow, these things have got to become a living reality to us so that we quit doing what it is we're doing. Because whatever we're doing outside of the Word of God is never going to get us to a place where the authority of God is going to bring change. But if we'll just sit down, lock into doing what God says in His Word, ultimately that is going to take us to a place of the greatest impact possible. It's going to have to be God's way. You're going to have to let God sort you out. You're going to have to understand that God sorts you out in the context of His church, where He's put apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. And yes, you can go and find 100 pastors that will fully disagree with me, if that's what you desire to do. But I'm going to tell you right now, it's the expense of the Word of God standing there, backing me up and declaring that I stand upon the high ground, testifying of those things which He declared when He spoke it out. God spoke to the fathers by the prophets in days gone by. But in these last days, He's spoken to us by His Son, whom He appointed heir of all things, by whom also He made the world. And there comes a sounding of a warning. If they did not escape the judgments after hearing Moses speak, of how much sore punishment should we consider that we would be thought worthy of if we don't listen to Christ Jesus, the Son who now speaks from heaven? Come on. What are you saying, Lord Jesus? What is your church supposed to be about? What is our attitudes? How do we approach unto you? Hapa Torinea. Speki and Lobusifretia. How do I make every chord that I strike on the guitar about worshiping Him? How do I make every song that I sing, every word and syllable about being unto Him? How do I make every dance, every shout, every adoration, every thanksgiving, every praise about Him? How do I make every activity of the energy that I receive from the food that He supplied for me about doing His work, about pursuing those things that belong to the kingdom of God? Come on, people. In this, we'll find a change. How do we begin to make the shift where it's more wonderful to talk to Father than to gab with other people around us? Because there is no lack of sin with a multiplicity of words. Hope for 1,000 tongues to sing in my Redeemer's praise rather than to talk about all this other stuff. Too many times I've been in meetings and they're just quiet and silent. Where it's just barely even any motivation when it was time talking to the Lord, we're praying, and you know, not just in this church, but other churches. But as soon as the meeting's over, it's like a roar. Because everybody's just so excited to talk to one another. Because they live in a sensual realm. They've never really been developed in the realms of the spirit. They've never been really developed in the interacting with the unseen. They've never really developed, been allowing God to develop their spirit. They've been so caught away in a material, earthly thing, concerned about what they shall eat and what they shall wear, all the rest of the stuff. Father wants a transition. He wants us to make a transition. Stop looking on the things which are seen and start looking on that thing which is unseen. For that which is seen is temporal, but that which is unseen is eternal. Start looking on those things that belong to another realm. Hallelujah. We just come to the Lord tonight and we ask Him to strengthen us and give us the ability, because when we think about these things and the value of the shout and the value of praise and the value of prayer, and we understand that we can pray with all prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost. In other words, He'll be the inspiration. He'll be the motivation. He'll cause and create the flow, that He'll produce the shout that will create the miracles, that we've been born of the Spirit to offer this praise. We were called out of darkness into His marvelous light that we may show forth His praise. We begin to understand that there is a realm that we can hook up in that will ultimately make all these other things that are earthly and worldly of no impact upon our life. But at the same time, we can be so caught up in the earthly and the worldly, and it has such a great impact upon our life, that the things of the Spirit are of very little value to us and of very little impact. And we're not touched deeply by it because we're consumed with what our Christmas presents are going to look like. We're consumed with our own earthly human interest of people's opinion. And the list goes on. Let's just be consumed with the fire of God. What does that mean? It means to be consumed with His presence, to be consumed with the fullness of His presence, the living, interactive, you can feel it like a fire presence. And the beauty of it is, it's so easy to step into this. It's so easy. But it's going to cost you everything. I don't believe that you can have what Paul had a different way than he had it. I don't believe that you can have what Jesus had a different way than he had it. Paul said, I have suffered the loss of everything. For the gospel, I've suffered the loss of everything, and I can't have it done, that I might win Jesus. I don't believe there's any other way. Hello. Does that bring sadness to your heart?
No.
This is just too much. You mean I got to give up pinball? Really? And that's about the height of it right there. Really, it's got that much of a hold on you that it would be that big of a loss. Really? Now you got something testifying against you. Huh? Because there should be nothing like, oh, you mean I got to give up? It should be dung to you, man. Huh? Think about that. Those are very descriptive words. Have you dealt with it like that? Have you looked at all the interests of your life and said, is that dung to me? Or is it important to me? Thank you, Jesus. Understand this. None of this is relevant. None of this is meaningful. None of this applies until you start looking at the Word of God, the living Word and the written Word, and seeing who He's made you and believing it. Because otherwise it's just going to be works. It's going to be dead works. Wood, stubble, and hay. It's going to be human effort, human discipline. And no flesh or glory in His presence. Amen. Hallelujah. Sotama ke shipata romo sifikinga. How many of you, if How many of you believe that you could actually live without the approval of any human being so long as you had the approval of God? That's good. That's good. Now just start practicing that. By making nothing else important but His approval. Where you just direct all that you want, and you just say, Lord, I'm doing this for you, and if this isn't what you want, I don't want it. Now all of a sudden you start, in that, you start practicing what you just raised your hand, saying that you could do, or would do. Thank you, Jesus. Just asking the Holy Ghost, stir this thing here, deep into our spirit. I'm not talking about giving up anything. I'm talking about gaining everything. Amen. Because when we're talking about saying goodbye to the world and distractions early, that's not anything. That's nothing. That a deception of temporal existence and overvaluing the meaning of this temporal life has resulted in. This life is about eternity. This life is not about temporality. This is life is a decision that we're making. It's a sorting out time where Father is seeing, He's made the way. And He's seeing who wants to walk with Him, who wants to live in His presence, and who doesn't. And that's what it is. And everybody has a right to know that. And they have a right to know it on the level that God wants to reveal it. And He's purposed that revelation come by way of you and I being so immersed in the Holy Ghost that we can't even be seen anymore. Holy Ghost. And that's why Satan fights. The Antichrist spirit that ultimately will be revealed in the person of the Antichrist does everything he can. That Antichrist spirit fights against the anointing, any manifestation of the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost is the one who reveals Jesus. But the focus of the Antichrist spirit is to fight against any manifestation of power, any manifestation of authority, any manifestation of the Spirit of the living God, especially tongues, miracles, signs, wonders. He's going to fight against it. And he comes at, that Antichrist spirit comes at everything that would be a primary factor in Jesus being revealed. For example, unity of the brethren. He's constantly, Antichrist spirit constantly creating division. His only opposition, the Antichrist spirit, the only opposition that the Antichrist has is the anointing in the church. Thus he focuses, Satan focuses all his work against it. And people, by and large, who've never really stepped in to gazing at this glorious, being fixed on the perfect or the complete word of liberty, law of liberty, fixed on the things of the Spirit. They're taken and they don't even know it. They're deceived and don't even know it. They're used by the enemy, don't even know it. Quite away, don't even know it. I hear people say, oh, well, he hurt me, speaking of me. Oh, he hurt me. No, I corrected you, and you didn't want to listen. Why don't you apply that to your 3- and 4-year-old kids? You hurting them, right, left, and center, correcting them. Somebody said, he rebuked me. No, I instructed you. The rebuke is much stronger. Huh? God uses rebuke on a much stronger level. He does that with the devil. He does that with Pharisees, right? Who? He rebuked them and said, who warned you? You know why? To flee from the wrath that is to come. Because I know you're not listening to God. Are you listening to me? And he also rebuked people for their unbelief. What is he? What, have you ever seen Jesus rebuke? Have you ever seen what it looks like when he rebukes? Have you ever seen what it looks like when he rebukes? Probably not. Because most people have only seen Jesus through the eyes of humanism. They've only seen Jesus through the eyes of their own perception, the lens of their own reality. It's not based on the Word of God. It's not found in the judgments of God. It's not found in the severity of His wrath. The severity of His judgments. It's just not found there. It's found through the eyes of humanism, the influence of humanism, the influences of rebellion. It is. And then we wonder, we would trample all over the anointing. We wonder why God don't move. You have to let God sort you out. You have to say, let the floodlight of heaven shine upon my soul and repent and change. And we know, everybody knows when repentance starts taking place, because you come up here to this altar and you start saying, Lord, I want to get this right. And you begin to submit yourself to the authority of the church. Satan has turned that into a bad word. Submit yourself to the authority of the church. Absolutely essential in the new covenant and rejected by a modern world society. Because it's a spirit of rebellion. When you begin to change, when you begin to look at this glory and you begin to want Jesus more than anything else, you begin to see what he's called you to be, all the stuff automatically starts working in your spirit. I want to be right. I want to be led in the right way. I want change. I want these things corrected in my life. Oh God, search me. Try me. See if there be any wicked way in me. Lead me in the way everlasting. Yeah, that's what happens. Holy Ghost conviction is able to move. We want Holy Ghost conviction to fall upon a lost and dying world, and we constantly resist the Holy Ghost. It ain't going to happen. We got to let Holy Ghost conviction fall on us. Yeah. Not just in the meeting, in the living room, in the workplace, wherever we're, in every place, where we live under the conviction of the Holy Ghost. That is the guidance, instruction, the right and wrong that the Holy Ghost himself imposes upon us and teaches us. If you will do this, church, if you will do this, God the Holy Ghost will allow you to enter into another, as it were, revelation and demonstration of the person of Jesus. Because that's what he's all about. He's not willing to take you or me and advance us in our cause. But when he sees us like Jesus' cause, Jesus' life, Jesus' purpose, Jesus' love, Jesus' way, putting the head where he should be, making his church what it should be, Holy Ghost takes us and says, come on, let's go. Then there's an increase. People want to have an increase without the increase of God. You're not going to have it. It's like people want to have, you know, prosper and be in health. Without an increase of the soul prosperity, it ain't gonna happen. Father's calling you tonight. He didn't lay these things out for you to just leave you powerless without the ability to follow through. Father is here to help you and me step into that which the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of the Son, is longing to take us, where Jesus would be glorified and adored in a deeper way. I think it was a week ago Sunday morning. The presence of Jesus was here so strong, I couldn't even sing. I tried singing. I couldn't sing. And his presence is there to be had and felt by every single person. I look at where the Lord's brought me now after 35 years of walking with him, and I realize, you know what? I could have had all of this so long ago. I didn't have to wait 35 years to be here right now. And I certainly don't want to wait another 35 years. I've got a longing in my soul. It's been told to me. I want you to listen to me because I want you to hear it. I want you to feel it. It's been told. It's been something that's been evidenced that many of God's revivalists cannot be pastors. They can't be. It hurts them too much. It's too much of a burden. They just got to go and be evangelists. Because you can't bring people along into that realm, and it becomes frustrating. They're overwhelmed. People won't go. People won't follow. So it's better just to go to different churches and spread it around. And then just, you know, leave with a fulfillment of it. At least it went from somewhere where you encountered it to something more of an expression, more of a hunger, more of a thirst, you know, to where everybody gets a little bit, as it were. Well, I'm telling you, listen to me. Spirit of the Lord anointed me and gave me the grace and the ability to pastor a church that would ultimately break the ties that bind. To pastor a church that would break through the barrier of those, those satanic hindrances that have effectively run interference against the glorious church being revealed. God the Holy Ghost knows exactly what's going on. He is dealing with every single person's heart in this place tonight. He knows the things that you've not been willing to submit to Him, surrender to Him. He just simply wants, He's asking you tonight to submit. He's asking you to surrender. He's asking you, don't go on in your way. Don't continue on in your own way. Somebody said, well, can you just be satisfied with a little growth? Sure. I'm not going to be happy about it. I can encourage it. Because I have faith and an expectation that it's going to be explosive growth. There's a beautiful thing about staying in the realm of faith. Because faith is the substance. Hallelujah. Those things that you are confident is going to happen. Hallelujah. Substance of the things that you're in expectation is going to happen. The evidence of things. That are unseen. Jesus is calling you. Hello? Jesus is calling you. Calling you to come stand with Him, come walk with Him. Come be hit, have your life hidden Him. Come be persecuted with Him, come suffer with Him. Come be rejected with Him. Come be glorified together with Him. Come be justified together with Him. We like that part, don't we? Come be glorified together, justified together. Hallelujah. Sanctified together. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
But also come be persecuted together with Him. Come be rejected together with Him. No problem. When you allow the Holy Ghost to begin to reveal Him and make Him everything that He is, what He's done for you and me, what Jesus did for you and me, what God did for you and me. He's removed all the sin away, dear people. He's removed it all away. He's removed everything that would keep us from being able to be holy and acceptable unto Him. He's removed it. He's taken it completely. He gave everything for you and me. So much so that even comes to the place that says, whatever you ask me, I'll do it. And I know that Father's waiting for a reciprocation because I saw the reciprocation in Jesus. Where we begin to say, Lord, whatever you ask me, I will do it. And Lord, I gladly lay down my life for you. Just start getting really earnest about being used by the Lord. Begin to set your heart upon Him. I guarantee you, Father's going to make a way. He's going to open a door. But get things right. Get things in order. Do it God's way. Do things God's way. Because I'm telling you, there's no shortcuts with the Lord. You're not going to end up with a good product in life doing it your own way. You're not going to end up with a good result if you do it half your way, half God's way. Well, you're not going to end up with a good result if it's 90% you, got 90% God and 10% you. You ain't going to end up with a good result. Jesus. I just want to stir you tonight. The Holy Ghost wants to stir you tonight with a longing to know Jesus, with a longing to have an encounter with Him, with a longing to be everything that He's created you to be. Just accept that. And in doing that, just staring at what He's given as a free gift, freely given. The Spirit of the Lord calls you so fall in love with Jesus, so fall in love with the things of heaven, that all this other stuff will begin to, it'll begin to become so apparent you won't have to try to figure it out, think it through, wonder about it. We won't have to sit around the table saying, Lord, is it I? He'll reveal it. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Kupatosini ki patea. Everybody, would you just stand with me? Hey, you younger, submit yourself to the elder. Young mothers, find older mothers whose results in their house you would like to see in your house, and follow them. Hear from them. Submit to them. Don't go find somebody who's got chaos in their house and say, how can I reproduce that? There's a divine order, okay? Just become a part of it. Make sure that you understand that the Holy Ghost will give you something, put something on the inside of you that will cause you to so love everybody around you that you're just totally connected with them. Just flows. Just let Him do it. Just be who He says you are. Will you? If you'll just start being who He says you are, you're going to get so captivated with Him. Everything's going to change. Thank you, Jesus. Say this with me. Say, I'm going to be. Who He says I am. I love the abiding place, I tell you right now. There's not a lot of places that's going to do this right here. So I want you to know that. We're not going to compare ourselves with others because it's not wise. But I'm going to tell you right now. I'm saying it by way of saying this. We're not far from being in a place that we must be for the Lord to take us and fully use us in the way that He's purposed to use us. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. Mosa panda de ki prevedeste. Hallelujah. Well, I want you to come worship the Lord with your giving. Just come worship the Lord. Be who God said you are.
You know, when I was ministering tonight, I heard some people saying in their heart, well, am I doing what God wants me to do? Let me just tell you this. All you have to do is lay it out before the Lord that way by saying, Father, I don't want to be doing anything that you haven't called me to do and that you don't want me to be doing. And I just ask you to show me, reveal it to me. You get earnest, and he's going to. You don't have to try to figure it out on your own. Don't wrestle with it. He'll show you. I can tell you right now, one thing that you're doing right. You're in the meeting. I was talking to some people today that I just love very dearly, and they said, well, there's one thing that you taught us. That is, if we want to move on with God and move on in the things of God, we've got to be in all the meetings. And we don't have enough meetings, so we want you to start having your own meetings. I want you to get ready. I want you to get ready for a great harvest. To where the move of God is so intense, we've got to be here every day. The move of the Spirit of the Lord is so overwhelming, we're going to be here, just here every night, because the harvest is coming in. The glory of God just overwhelming the hearts of the people. Just begin to long for that. Just begin to long for a visitation, a greater visitation. Yeah, he's with us all every day. Yes, his manifest presence is here. But yes, it can be displayed in a far greater way. That's just important for us to grab a hold of. It can be displayed in a far greater way. And I won't be satisfied until he comes walking down the aisle. And he kind of stands up on the platform and says, listen, I just want to take the meeting from you. One thing have I desired, and that will I seek after, that I may behold his glory in his temple, which I have. This temple right here is temple. Amen? Amen. Can you say that? Yes. Have you beheld the glory of the Lord in his temple, in his house? Have you beheld his glory in his temple, in his house? I'm talking about you. You being his house. You being his temple. Have you beheld the glory? Yes. Have you beheld the glory? You listen to me. If you haven't beheld the glory, I want you to grab hold of the Word of God. Start reading it. Just like I told you. Start looking. Just be like Moses and take the veil off and behold the glory of the Lord looking in the mirror. And there you're going to be changed. But there's still more. There's still more. There's still more. I said there's still more. There's still more. There's still more. There's more. Yes. There's growth. There's maturity. Somebody trying to convince me that there was more said, does a tree try to be a tree? I said, no, a tree doesn't try to be a tree. But nonetheless, it grows and matures to a point where you can never knock it down. And it ain't no some little squawny little, you know, some little Charlie Brown Christmas tree or some little twig sticking up out of the ground. It turns into something that reaches up 1,000 feet into the air and it's 6 to 8 foot wide in diameter. Don't you tell me that's the same thing as that twig sticking up out of the ground. They're not. Not in any way, not in any kind, not in any sort, other than in their lordship. Praise God, we're Father's purpose that we grow mature. Hallelujah. And I'm certain the Spirit of the Lord will crush Satan under our feet very shortly. All the things that have hindered, all the things that have stood in the way, all the things that the powers of darkness, the spirit of humanism, and the spirit of religion, the satanic realm has run, as it were, a hindrance against the flow of God. I'll tell you right now, first of all, the Lord has given us the capacity to have already busted through it. But the beautiful thing about it is, if we delay too long, he'll come bust a way through and say, come on in. And you know what I'm saying?
one way or the other was going to happen. Just rise up. Just rise up. Let's put on our strength. Let's put on our strength. Let's grab a hold of ourselves like men in the things of the Spirit. Let's begin to behold Jesus. Let's begin to behold the things of heaven. Let's begin to behold the throne room of God and the purposes that He has purposed for this earth. Men are speaking against, I'm saying this, it's very important because understanding what the prince of the power of the air is trying to do. Men, even in the Pentecostal movement, speaking railing accusations against God's authority in the believer. I tell you what, they've totally forsaken the heavenly vision. Heavenly vision says, Father has given me power, authority, to turn people from Satan to God, from darkness to light, to open up their blinded eyes. To bind whatever I bind on earth, He'll bind it in heaven. Whatever I loose on earth, He'll loose in heaven. I can't help it that they're going to distill their doctrine from their experience and what they see and rewrite the Bible. To make it belong to another generation, another time, something that has passed away and can live no more. Now it's time that God's people rise up. Take it. Already say it's mine. You say it's mine. You take it. You already say it's mine. You behold the glory. It's already mine. It's given to me. You don't bend. You don't bow. You don't get swayed by all these things, other circumstances, popular opinion. Stand. Sub voce anima. And speak the word of life. Speak. Speak these words. Thank you, Jesus. 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 What Father has purposed to do is He's purposed to bring a harvest into a place, into a house, into a church, where that when the harvest comes in, what they see is Jesus. Everywhere they look, they see someone that they're going to follow after, that they're going to be just like. You know, Summer was telling me. She said when she responded to the altar call. She didn't really feel like anything happened when she responded to the altar call. She said, but what happened when so many people came up hugging her and telling her that they loved her and just blessing her, she said that an event took place in my life. She said, I was born again when that started happening. I began to be changed by the power of God. And, you know, there are just so many dimensions of the glory of Christ Jesus that Father's purpose to be revealed through us, that is just such a blessing to participate with. And everything of this world and everything that you've held on to about yourself is going to be such a blessing for you to get rid of. It's going to be such a blessing for you to no longer be burdened and entangled and compromised by it, so that you can walk out in a greater way this beauty. Jesus. Have you ever seen the glory of the Lord in His temple? Hey? Yes. Come on now. Yes. Have you seen the glory of the Lord in His temple? And I'm talking about your house, your temple. Yes. You are the temple of the Lord. Have you seen the glory? Yes. Did you look into the mirror? Did you look into the Word of God? Did you believe what God said? Did you believe what He said about you? Do you believe God's report, what He said about His only begotten Son, what He's done for you? I pray in Jesus' name that tonight you see better than you've ever seen before. That you fall so deeply in love with Jesus that everything becomes about service to Him, the Master. I want to pray with anyone who's got a sick heart, a hurting heart. You feel overwhelmed. You feel somehow shut out. Somehow these things aren't real to you, not meaningful to you as they ought to be. If there's anybody like that, I want to pray with you. I want you to know tonight that there is no being left out.
There's no being the person that God has not extended His love and His mercy towards. We want everybody to leave in this place tonight with a full heart, in full assurance, fully surrendered, fully ready to change, being transfigured by the Spirit of the Lord, and in every way bearing the image of Jesus. Amen. Anybody sick or diseased in your body, anybody, any problems spiritually, physically, financially, whatever problems, overwhelmed in any way, areas of your life that you know that aren't right, that you want change, you want to submit them to God, you don't want to be that way anymore. Look, there are things that where I watch people, they say, I know it's wrong, what I'm doing is wrong, and I don't want to be like this anymore, but they've never really truly repented, got it right, and broke the demon spirit that harasses them, torments them, and takes authority over their life. Things aren't broken off. Things need to be broken off. They've broken off their repentance. There's things going on in your life that you know is wrong. And all you need to do is just repent of them. Make things right with anybody around you if there is an offense. Submit yourself to God's way. Not just part of the way, go all the way. Submit yourself to His Word, to His Spirit, to the leadership over you in your life. Because all of those things, Father has given for our growth and maturity. The Word, growth, did you know that? Everybody knew that? Anybody didn't know that? Word was given for our growth. Did you know that? Yes. Three things God says given for growth, Spirit, and those who set over you in the Lord. You can't have two-thirds and get it right. I'm going with the Word and the Spirit, but forget about the leadership. You hear me?
Yes.
Because the Lord says that what you do to those that you can see, really, you do to Him. He said, how can you say you love the Lord whom you've not seen when you hate your brother whom you have seen? And he brings that whole dynamic down. Let's get this right. Say, a house divided
cannot stand.
We want one head. We want one leader. Christ Jesus.
Hallelujah.
And He's got that laid out, how that works. And we can grow up into Him, into all things, who's ahead. To whom every part of the body is connected. And to that connection, He supplies to every, to the whole of the being. So that a supply then can flow out from each of us to each other. So that the church may make increase, make growth, make increase of itself in love. To just recognize when you start really wanting to know Him, when you really want to start grabbing a hold of this thing about seeing Him, you recognize to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge. They're being filled with all the fullness of God. Father's made it so simple. Let's just do it. Yes. Just do it. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. We'll find a bunch of people around you. Hug them. Tell them that you love them. Bless them in Jesus' name. I love you too. I'm here to pray for anyone who needs prayer for anything. How's your heart? Huh? Is it beating fast? No, beat it fast. more reading fast. Can you feel it beating fast right now? He's healing you right now.
Yes.
Praise Jesus, healing you right now. What is it that you need? Healed right now in Jesus' name. Lord, we thank you for touching a sweet little baby. Another sweet little baby. Jesus. Faith! Like never before. Surging through your spirit. What you need?
Everything God said through you tonight.
You want everything He said tonight? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for this peace that passes all understanding. Thank you for this boldness and this confidence. Thank you, Jesus. Master Inande K is to put a dying brevekish to Belonanko day. Increase. 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 Hapro sikande ibreba erete ishito rebostriti. The Avrum must die. Defra defeti sika sata feete sutara da seki. Makae kino mushipate de potam. Ah, sati. Ah. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we thank you for great provision. Amen. We thank you for great provision. I thank you for great faith. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hey, we're gonna bless Annalyn with an offering. So, go get an offering. So, just come bless her. And just somebody said, what am I gonna do? You're gonna come and put it on her lap. Okay, just come and just put it on her, just bless her. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the fire and the Holy Ghost. Arrabostere dei bratavre se craste tondereste. Mambrande vecchina moshe prangaya. Le refeti si caranai. Aste peranai brovosa. A great outpouring of the Holy Ghost. Great outpouring of the things of heaven. Manzeres dying. The Boris de Brevecao, Avradan de Lepicaia, Mosatana de Restak Topoyoshinai, Manshi Remoyoshi. Hallelujah. Manshi Remoshi Yardad. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Just being full of the Holy Ghost. Be filled and continually filled and overwhelmed. Great boldness and confidence in Jesus. Woo.
Jesus. Mangando ribebre vitere to poca shivia to domonde.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Great peace. Great peace. Great peace.
Let me get it right.
You are. You are. Good. That's all the Lord needs. That's all He needs to work with right there. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Just be continually filled with the Spirit. See what Jesus did when He made you a new creation. Just look and see Jesus inviting you into a whole new realm of living. Stand with Him in the life that He lives. To be baptized with Him in the baptism that He gives. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Father's looking for the opportunity to form and shape women, young women, older women, in His glory, so that there may be women filled with the Holy Ghost, women of the Spirit, women who know their God. Women who are full of faith and authority in the Spirit and in the Word. So you be one of those. Just be one of those. You be one of those. Thank you for the anointing. Thank you for the anointing. Oggi si corre sto pane. Oggi si gira sto. Merestati. Merestati lo soffresco. Merestati sì. Mestre fra. Mandere Cristo per. Jesus. Jesus in me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for this anointing. Out of your belly flows the
these rivers, rivers of God, out of your belly flows. Be right back. Be right back. Stay right there. There you go. Bolsa kina manda leya para burase. Si tanda de besta kiri be pridosto. Mandebre bandesto. Yes, be what God says you are. Be what God says you are. Be what God says you are. You'll never step into those things of His glory until you're willing to be what He says you are. You'll never step into a greater dimension of authority until you simply are willing to be what He says you are. Now, in Jesus' name, comfort to your heart. Rest your soul. Never put on your Facebook again that an exercise room is your favorite place to be.
One of my favorite. Not the favorite.
Don't even say it's one of them. Bess upon. Looky here. You don't even have your own way anymore. You're under the command of the Almighty, the captain of the host. And just excited about everything He says. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Be who He says you are. My God, tell you, Shephra. Monde bredese. Mainly down bandali. Bless. Mondes. Balastavik. Membrasavist. Yes, it bounds me. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, my God.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. That's right, just keep rejoicing. That's good. Hey, Mom. How are you? Great with child. Bless your heart. How are you girls doing tonight? You're doing good. It's good to have you in church. What's your name?
Anne-Marie.
And what's your name again? Huh?
Osea.
I'm sorry.
Osea.
Osea and Emery. And Emery, you're from San Diego. What grade are you in?
Fifth.
You're the fifth grade. What do you like about life? particular that you like about life? What's your favorite things to do?
Is
what?
Is to go to school.
Have you ever invited the living God come step on the inside of you? Did you know that He wants to? The living God. His name is Christ Jesus. He wants to come step on the inside of you with His Spirit. Literally, the Spirit of God. This is no, I'm not kidding you. The Spirit of the living God wants to come and live on the inside of you. That is very different. You're not going to get that in school. But He wants to. All you have to do is let Him. And your life will be blessed. Your life will be good. You'll live a heavenly life. Spirit of the living God comes to live on the inside of us so that we may live a heavenly life. Otherwise, the spirit of the world has dominion over us, and it's not a heavenly life at all. It's a hellacious life. It gets bad. Of course, we see a lot of people doing a lot of bad things, right? You want to let the Spirit of the living God come on the inside of you. Let Jesus Christ come on the inside of you. Okay. Father, we ask You in the name of Jesus, change everything about him in this life tonight. She may have an encounter with You. Come to know that You really are who You say You are. Do you ever go to church anywhere? No? Is this your first time in church? We're glad you came. Christ Jesus changes you tonight. Everything that the powers of darkness would try to put upon you and the world would try to put upon you is broken off of you now. The name of Jesus and the blood of Jesus is applied to your life. And everything changes. Power of God comes upon you. And you become a new creation. You become a new person. In Jesus' name. Holy Ghost, come into this life. Spirit of the living God, come fill this life. Thank you, Jesus. So I want you to just close your eyes for just a second. Say, Jesus.
Jesus.
Come into my life. Change me.
Change me.
I'm going to live for You.
What?
I'm going to live for You.
I'm going to live for You.
I'm going to be what You purpose me to be.
What you purpose me to be.
I'm going to come to understand what it is that You purpose me to be. I'm going to come to a place of understanding.
I'm going to come to a place of understanding.
What it is. Dying on a cross for me.
For dying on a cross for me.
And raising from the dead.
Raising up from the dead.
So that I can live right now with You. And so that You can live in me. Thank You, Jesus.
Thank You, Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
What do you want? What do you want? Has all of those things for you, and in that order. So you know what the cure for depression is? Joy. Just the opposite. So right now, in the name of Jesus, be filled with joy. And from this day forward, live in joy. Joy unspeakable and full of glory. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. I charge you to live in joy. Now that's, you know, that's a nice saying, charge is a nice biblical way of saying I command you. A lot of people go, well, you command me. He's commanding me. I command you by the authority of Jesus Christ to live in joy. You see? Because all the things of this world will try to put depression upon you. God wouldn't put depression upon you and sorrow upon you. Things of this world will try to think those kinds of things on you. Now break that off of you now in the name of Jesus. You, the property of the living God, bought and purchased with the blood of Jesus, made a new creation through the power of the resurrection, born of the Word and born of the Spirit, to live your life for God, in Jesus' name. In the mighty name of Jesus, I command a blessing upon your life so that you have provision aplenty, that you follow the shepherd and have no lack, in Jesus' name, that you have not only the provision that you need, but the job, a good one too, that you find that He is your shepherd, He is your provider, He is your protector, your keeper. So now just let your hands towards Him. Just lift those hands up. I saw you with those hands lifted up back there. Worship in Jesus' name. You just receive. You just receive. You just receive. You just receive right now. Just like the woman with the issue of blood, there was all kinds of things and trying to stop her and hinder her from touching Jesus, but she knew if all she needed to do is touch Jesus, she touched Him, all that she had need of would be supplied. The sickness and the disease that she couldn't get rid of would be cured. She knew within herself that Jesus was the answer. Things change for you. Thank you, Jesus. Things change for you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. What a great Savior, healer, provider. Thank you, Jesus, for loving us so much. Thank you, Father, that you love us so much that you gave us the Holy Ghost. So you just be filled with the Holy Ghost.
Filled up. Se pacco tabacana que mexicato. Mande que si botara te sia. Filled up, barumara te seguida, about to say.
With all kinds of the languages of heaven. All kinds of utterance right out of the realms of the Spirit. With every dimension of the word of faith. Amen. Tandong bengonde, bongade, badande, bocando sepera, hale mateus. Father, I thank you that you take your daughter and you make her a sponge for heaven. A sponge for the things of the Spirit. The Lord just wants to make you a woman of the Spirit. Wants to make you a woman of faith. It's a beautiful and a glorious thing to be. Want everything that He has. Don't let religion get in the way. Don't let nothing block you out of the way from the more that He has for you. Because the things you ask for Him, they're simple for Him to do. And as I said, He's done them. The depression has to leave you and go. The provision of heaven's yours. The Father's got so much more. And He's, you know, the best thing He's got. He's like, if you know are evil, know how to give good gifts for to your children. Wait till you see what I got for you. And then He rolls out the best thing He's got, and people don't even know what it is. They almost like act like it's nothing, but it's the Holy Ghost. The realms of glory. Amen. These things are yours. In Jesus' name, they're yours, and nothing's going to get in your way. In Jesus' name. Amen. bless her too, Lord Jesus. What you want? Anything in particular? It's yours. Manga de keto boku take ne me keto boku ta shibiru tu sifa tu fa na mokipa. Mungji bo fati boku te shibo shda. Wisdom says, I love them that love me, and those that seek me early shall find me. And Father says, furthermore, that he gives wisdom liberally. All you have to do is ask. He withholds none of it, none of his wisdom. From anyone who asks. Father, thank you for the anointing. Thank you for the anointing right here. Thank you, Jesus, for the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Ha, riba seteha. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Why do you look like the cat that ate the canary? Palanea, Palanea Porosia. Kirimosasti, Mumba dea Pocomoshi Papa, Bongo Munga Pacane, Bongo Puntos and the Kinga, Bonga Namangis de Beranoshipa, Bonga Topatena Maisi, Bonga Tana Makia Pacatoya, Bonga Dashi Pea Taraha, Bonga Reste Prevedes to Pocadi Motolania. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we thank you that you take us all the way to the place that you've called us to go. Father, we thank you that you take us all the way to the place that you've called us to come. Father, we thank you that you take us all the way. We're not stopping. Lord, we're going all the way with you. And your Lord, you're the one who leads. And you're the one who gives us the ability to do so. Hallelujah. So, Father, we thank you once again that you take us all the way to the place that you've called us to come. Amen. Praise God.
It's the Holy Ghost that strengthens you and empowers you. It's the living word that gives you the ability.
Time that you spend in the Word to be more glorious so that all negativity is canceled by the positivity. You hear me?
Yes.
I guarantee you, you can walk in the realms of the Spirit that everything becomes under the influence of the Holy Ghost and you're not affected by some kind of problems. Okay? And in other words, what you're saying is you get around a bunch of doubt and unbelief. That's what you're calling negativity, but I just call it doubt and unbelief. And what the Father wants to communicate to your life is faith in the things of the Spirit, which is what you refer to as positivity, but I call faith in the Holy Ghost.